Good afternoon. Welcome, everybody. Good afternoon. I'm Michelle Sizemore, and I am the Senior Vice President of Product Operations for Athleta, as well as I oversee the Gap Bank product innovation initiatives, again, across the enterprise. I'm really pleased to be here this afternoon to welcome you on behalf of Gap Inc., our family, focusing on the business case for carbon tax. It's a real honor, and it's very important to us as an organization. And I just tell you a little bit about Gap Inc., and tell you a little bit about the brand Athleta as well, and why we decided to get involved in today's event. Gap Inc. was founded by Don and Doris Fisher in 1969. And they had a vision of creating a global brand with a purpose and not just about making clothes. And nearly 50 years later, Athleta and Gap Inc.'s family of all of our brands, we are continually motivated by a shared vision that being a force for good makes good business sense. So again, we are so honored to have you here. It's really important to us. It's important to who we are as an organization and to our values. Let me tell you a little bit about Athleta. Athleta is one of our brands inside of our portfolio. And Athleta is a mission-driven brand. And it's a mission-driven brand. The mission is to ignite a community of women and girls to uplift one another to reach their potential. And how we bring that mission to life is really critical. It's the how. And I'm super excited to let you guys know, if you don't know, this past spring, Athleta earned our B Corp certification. I love sharing that, and it's interesting how many people don't know this. And again, it's not only what we stand for, but it's how we do it, which is super critical. And so what that makes is Gap Inc. is now one of the world's largest publicly traded retail companies with a B Corp certified subsidiary. And we are going to continue on this path, and we want to encourage our other brands and our competitors around the world to do the same. So the other thing about Athleta is 80% of our product environmental impact is tied to the decisions that we make when we are building our product. So really around the fibers that we select, the materials we select, the types of manufacturing technologies, how much water we're using. The other thing that is really important to us is the timing by which we make these decisions. So it's really important that we're still relevant in the consumer eyes and being right with fashion. But when we make the decision, will allow us to move our materials and our products once they're manufactured to our customer in the best possible way, having as small of an impact as we possibly can. So giving ourselves, so all of these decisions that we make in the brand, from when you walk in our door to the person that's running the mailroom to the people making the material selection through it, it's not a team that sits outside in some room and tells us what to do. This is inherent in every single person that works at our brand, and that's why we can actually really make such a positive impact, which is cool. And a lot of people ask me, what's the secret with Athleta? And there's three things. It's when we can combine beauty and functionality with sustainability, that is the magic of our brand, because one without the other, that's what we have found. So we combine the three together, and that's what our magic sauce is. So when people ask, tell them. We want everybody to do it. So we recognize environmental issues are fundamentally human rights issues. And we are currently working at Gap Inc. to cut our greenhouse gas emissions across our owned and operated facilities in half by 2020. And that is a big statement. And we are active on it, and we are on our way to achieve our goal. Awesome. You know, the other thing that we're also doing, we're also working to set a science-based target goal for our entire supply chain. So that is huge. We're in the process of developing it, and so more to come on that. So again, super, really thrilled on behalf of Gap Inc. to host this event. We are honored. We know that there is, you're going to start, Richard. I'm going to pass over to Richard, who is co-chairing the event. And I think we're going to start and kick it off by a panel. So I'll turn it over to you so we can get started. And then we'll see you at the end of the day. And we're going to host a little event as well here about, I think, around 5 o'clock when we end. So you guys, thank you for being here. Can't thank you enough for the work that you're doing and just really honored. And with that, Richard,
and Michelle, turn it over. And thank you and your colleagues so much for hosting us today.
Yeah, and everybody in the room that helped put this together. A lot of people, really. So do good work. We can't wait.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, you guys. Good. Thank you.
Well, great. Well, welcome, everyone. Hi, I'm Richard Eidlin, one of the co-organizers of the Carbon Tax Forum, my colleague Harold Hedelman, who you'll hear from in a moment. And we're really thrilled that you're here today. And this is an opportunity to talk about a particular solution to the large-scale problem of climate change. And that solution is putting a price on carbon and establishing a tax. So today's conversation includes a variety of points of view from the right to the left about how we tax something that we need less of. And we're going to look at a number of different solutions, both that apply at the federal level and at the state level, and have five panels for you today that will take you through a number of different perspectives. And we're quite enthusiastic about what we put together today because it includes NGO perspectives, social justice, political, meaning elected leaders, and a number of environmental organizations and think tanks that have been really involved in thinking about a carbon tax and how it would work. So what we hope you get out of today's program is a better understanding of how you'd actually establish a tax, where do you set the price, what do you do with the revenues, and the impact that that will have on the broader economy. We haven't designed this program to endorse one particular point of view. And as you'll hear, there are, in fact, a number of perspectives, all valid, all politically calculated to achieve success. And each of those views from the right and the left are designed to help solve a number of common problems. So format-wise, we're going to work quickly. We're going to really try to stay on time. And rather than have you pose questions by raising your hand and having a microphone to ask that question, we're going to ask that you jot those questions down. Excuse me, and we have runners who will pick those questions up. So if you want a card, a 3x5 card, to write your question down, they'll bring them up to the moderators, and we'll sort through them and try to, you know, answer as many of those questions as possible. So thank you all for being here, and Harold, turn it over to you.
Thank you, Richard. Can I be heard okay? Oh, great, thanks. Well, I want to welcome you on behalf of Business Climate Leaders, which is an action team of Citizens Climate Lobby. I really thank you for being here. I know we share something really important by being here today, so thank you. I also want to thank the wonderful team of Business Climate Leader volunteers, both in the room and around the country, who worked really hard to put this together. And thanks likewise also to the CCL volunteers in the room today who's helped to get registered and checked in and everything. We're a fantastic team. I'm going to tell you a little bit about Business Climate Leaders and also about Citizens Climate Lobby, and then we'll kick off the first panel. About 4 years ago, before Business Climate Leaders existed, I was organizing a public panel, believe it or not, on the topic, can the right and left agree on a price on carbon? We're a little closer today. We're not there, but we're closer. At the very end of that panel, one panelist stood up and gave us a challenge. He talked to the audience and said, if you're from Citizens Climate Lobby, I have a challenge for you. Talk to the big retailers, like Gap. Show them how your proposal will put money in the pockets of their consumers, of their customers, and watch them line up to support you. That was the last thing that was said. People clapped, they rose, they were leaving, but a group of us, CCLers, gathered and we decided to take that challenge on. And that was the beginning of Business Climate Leaders. The panelist who stood up was Bill Shireman from Future 500, one of our sponsors today. And Bill and his team at Future 500 have supported us in the interim. So I really want to thank Bill. I don't know if he made it today.
He's supposed to.
He's supposed to. Eric is over here. And if you want to hear more about Future 500, find Eric. It's a terrific group. They helped us every day since then in learning how to work with businesses, how to find the middle path and be successful at that. BCL is an action team of Citizens Climate Lobby. We have a number of action teams, and this is one of our more dynamic ones. We have a goal of, broadly speaking, engaging businesses and encouraging their participation in advancing a national carbon tax. So that's we're focused on that, just like CCL. And what's been important is that once we start working with companies, we try and provide the role of informing and educating and helping them understand how a carbon tax can affect their company and what kinds of nuances there are that they need to think about before they take steps towards advocacy. So that's what we do. We would hope, for example, that if any of you are from companies that want to learn more, we'd have a conversation, figure out what next steps are that might lead to talking about the carbon pricing principles. Hopefully some of you have taken a little look at them. They were on your chairs. And after talking about the principles, that might lead to discussing opportunities for joint advocacy. That's the kind of trajectory that we like to see happen. So we'll talk more about business climate leaders in the last panel today. But now I want you to know a little bit about Citizens Climate Lobby, because if it weren't for them, I wouldn't be here. We probably wouldn't be here. Well, I just want to say that both in Congress and nationwide, CCL has done more than any organization that I know of to promote awareness of carbon taxes as a foundational solution to climate change. The root of CCL's success is the value it places on relationships. For volunteers, that means we provide them a really deep infrastructure of support that empowers their advocacy. For the people that we lobby, it means that when we get into a lobby meeting, even with a darkest, deepest climate denier, we treat them with appreciation and respect. And because of that core value, we've been able to do some amazing things in Congress. For example, catalyze the creation and the growth of the Climate Solutions Caucus in the House, which now, as if you don't know, has 43 Republicans and 43 Democrats in its ranks. And even if some of those are there for the greenwashing, we see that as a success, because they at least recognize that they need to do that to stay in office. If you're from CCL, well, I want to tell you why they joined. Those members of Congress joined because we asked them. How did we get access? We got access because CCL has chapters that cover every district in the country, every congressional district. They asked because we met with them over 1,700 times last year. We published over 4,300 letters to the editor, op-eds, and editorials around the country. Held several thousand meetings community meetings to stir up public support for action on climate. So those are all reasons they joined. And I want to say that it's important to do this kind of work at the grassroots level in addition to the work that we do, which is with businesses, both large and small. If you're from CCL, either on staff or as a volunteer, just kind of raise your hand. And those of you who are not with CCL, look around. These are people you can talk to if you are interested in Citizens Climate Lobby. So thank you. Given that this is a climate action summit, I wanted to say that because I wanted you to realize that CCL is really taking a lot of actions at the grassroots level. And I think that what we do demonstrates the beginning of, as Van Joan puts it, bipartisanship from the bottom up. And businesses, I think both big and small, have a really crucial role to play in making that happen. So let's head it.
Good, thanks. Good, Harold, thank you. And why don't we have the first panel come on up. And while they're coming to stage,
I'm so glad you made it.
I want to make sure everybody notices who the sponsors are and who helped to make this happen. So thank you to all the sponsors who contributed time and money and really helped pull this all together. So hello, Greg. Good to see you. Good.
Thanks for having
me. Okay, everyone have a microphone? All right, good. So this first panel, and by the way, This is being live streamed, so those of you here in the audience, be on your best behavior. And those of you on the internet, we welcome you and appreciate you joining us. And I think there are about 300 people watching this live across the country. So this first panel is really designed to get a better understanding of what a carbon tax is. And so we have a number of perspectives here and also a number of prescriptive policy solutions, particularly from all four organizations. But we're going to hear more about that. So here are our panelists. To my right is Steve Hams from Business Climate Leaders, Greg Bertelsen from the Climate Leadership Council in Washington, D.C., Helen Montford from World Resources Institute, and Alex Flint from the Alliance for Market Solutions. Thank you. So Helen, let me start with you first. When we think about a tax, my first sense is it changes behavior. It's designed to change behavior and do away with something that's maybe not good, and then we have to think about what do we do with the revenue that's raised from that tax. So in the work that you do as a senior economist at WRI, I know you've thought a lot about tax policy and now carbon taxes. So what is and what would be a carbon tax? How would that work in the United States?
Thanks very much, Richard. I mean, as you say, taxes are there often initially to change behavior, to try and encourage changing behavior. They also have other benefits as well, including raising revenues, which is incredibly important to cash-strapped governments who have to fund various priorities. So, I mean, you could compare it, for example, to something like a cigarette tax, right? And so putting a tax on cigarettes encourages people to reduce their consumption, their use of cigarettes. It also raises revenue, which the government can use for other priorities, healthcare, infrastructure investment, et cetera. So carbon taxes are really similar, right? Putting a tax on the combustion of fossil fuels and the production of carbon, it's a pollutant to the economy, so this is something where you can internalize that cost. By putting that in place, you encourage companies, individuals, others to reduce their carbon emissions. You encourage them to shift away from high carbon activities, move towards ones which are more efficient, energy efficient, less polluting. From doing that, you're actually realizing incredible health benefits often because of the air pollution impacts we have with fossil fuel burning. But in addition, you're starting to raise revenues. And we've got some fantastic examples of where we're seeing carbon taxes and prices really raise revenues around the world. I think one of the differences with a carbon tax is that it's also a major incentive to innovate, right? Those, the businesses, the consumers, the individuals, they carbon tax, a price on carbon, gives them the opportunity to reduce emissions however they see fit. Whatever works best for them, they're able to choose whatever technologies or approaches, depending what works best for them. And it provides them an incentive to find new technologies, new approaches, which can actually produce, for example, the same amount of steel or cement, but with less carbon emissions. So that innovation aspect is one of the ones that we really emphasize about carbon taxes.
So would I, if I'm going to the store, notice this? Or how do I, as a citizen, as a consumer, pay this carbon tax? Or does this get placed on a finite number of large industrial polluters?
Well, it really depends how you actually apply it in the economy and what it's where it's applied. In most cases, what we've seen countries or states or provinces tend to apply it upstream to the production of the emissions. So that might be, for example, in the energy sector or the electricity sector as you're actually consuming this. So then downstream, you might see a slight difference in prices, but perhaps not that much in most cases. In many cases, in a lot of places which have carbon prices or taxes in place and have for a number of years, consumers, businesses don't really notice them, to be frank. It's actually quite small compared to all the other costs that go into a product, for example, labor and production and the goods that go in there. So it really varies quite a bit, but in most cases it's not noticed. I think what is really essential is how the revenues are then used.
And let me hold you on that for a moment. So how do you set the price? You know, do you put it, is it $6 a ton, $100 a ton? How do you make that decision?
So ideally, the price should really be set based on the cost of pollution. pollution, carbon emissions are a cost to our society. They're a cost to humans, they're a cost to what we're doing in the world today, and you should set it at the price, what we call the social costs of carbon to society. What we've found in most cases in most countries is that people tend to start fairly small with a carbon tax. They introduce it at a relatively small level, but those that are most successful, they build in a mechanism to increase the price over time. And they pre-announce that. And the reason this is most successful is it gives the opportunity to businesses, to industry, to consumers to actually adjust their behavior as those prices come forward. They can see that the price is increasing. It might be starting at $10 per ton and then going up to 15, 20, 25. And they can see that projection. And as they go about their everyday activities, for example, you know, replacing a vehicle or getting new refrigerators, they can choose ones over time which are more energy efficient and less emitting.
Okay.
So it allows them that foresight.
Good, good. Let me ask you to hold on that point, but I know you had, we have a slide, so tell us what's the story here.
Yeah, this is,
sorry.
This
sorry.
Is, yep, it flicks between the two dates. Okay. I'll explain the slide briefly. I mean, this is really just to show the exciting momentum that we're actually seeing today around carbon pricing around the world. This includes both carbon taxes and cap and trade systems. And when you see what's actually been happening the last few years, very few people are quite aware of this. In 2004, we had less than 1% of global greenhouse gas emissions covered by some kind of carbon price. Today, we have 20% of global emissions that are either covered by a carbon price or a carbon price is planned to be put in place. So what you can see there is actually 2008 and then 2018. So 2008, there's not a lot that's going on. It's mainly Europe, a little bit in Canada. And when you see the 2018 slide, you see how far this has spread around the world. It's now 70 jurisdictions, countries, provinces, or states that have carbon pricing in place, and it includes our neighbors in Mexico, in Canada, Chile, Colombia. Argentina has announced they're putting a carbon price in place in 2019.
Okay.
So we've got a lot around the neighborhood.
Good, good, good. And I want to just make a distinction here before I turn to Steve, that what we're talking about is a tax, and rather than an emissions trading system. And so California has a great cap and trade system here, right? But today's conversation is not about emissions trading. It's really about a different fiscal policy. And so with that, and we'll come back, Helen, in a moment. But Steve, so with business climate leaders and Citizens Climate Lobby, you have a particular prescriptive policy that's been crafted over a number of years. And tell us what's influenced
the details.
The details, yeah, thanks.
Well, thanks. And Helen did such a terrific job of giving us an overview of the carbon pricing landscape. And I thought it would be useful to talk some specifics about the particular policy that CCL and our business climate leaders team advocate and have been for many years. CCL has been around for 10 years, and this has been our singular focus for that period of time. So the keys to our proposal, there's three legs to the stool, if you will. The first is to place a fee on fossil fuels, and as Helen says, our proposal does so upstream, so it's at the well or at the mine or at the port, and it places a fee starting at $15 a ton, which is fairly low, keeps a shock to the economy low, and then increases every year by $10 a ton. That's a very important feature of the policy because it's a very clear signal to the economy, to businesses, that's where we're headed. And as Helen mentioned, it's a real stimulus for innovation when you know that that's the direction that the economy is going. Second leg to the stool is what do we do with the revenue? Well, our belief is that the best use of the revenue is to return all of it to American households so that the government does not keep it. So what's the reasoning behind that? Two major ones. First of all, it's economically stimulative when you put the money back in people's pockets because they spend it. And I'll show you the results of an economic study that that indicated what happens to the economy when this gets implemented. And then the other key aspect of that is that it's not, we like to say, if the government doesn't keep the money, it's not a tax. So what that means is that it can bring in people from across the political spectrum. There's many on the conservative side that really don't want to grow government. They don't like the idea of new taxes that are going into government programs. So those are the two key elements of why that's important. Thirdly, we have what we call a border carbon adjustment, and that keeps businesses whole, if you will, from competition from countries that don't have an equivalent carbon fee. So if they, you know, if they export to countries that don't have it, they get their fee reimbursed, and then products that come in from other countries that don't have it have to pay it at the border. So those are the three key elements. And we had CCL is a very data-driven organization, and several years ago we asked a very reputable organization called Regional Economic Modeling, Inc., to study what the impact would be over 10 and 20 years of the implementation of carbon fee and dividend. And these are the key results. They found that compared to a base case, that after 20 years, we'd have the economy would have 2.8 million more jobs. The emissions would be reduced by 52% from 1990 levels. The dividend by that time would be, for a household of four, around $400 a month. It would have a significant health impact. We'd prevent over 200,000 premature deaths by that time, and would actually increase GDP cumulatively by about $1.3 trillion. So from my perspective, when I look at various carbon pricing proposals, I think personally that there's three major criteria that I use to evaluate them. The first one is effectiveness, second is durability, and the third one is fairness. And when you look at effectiveness, the first point is that it reduces emissions by 52%. And that's, after all, that's our Uber objective, right? Is to create a livable world to reduce emissions. So it's very effective from that point of view. Secondly is durability. And there's two reasons why it's durable. Number one, once you get Americans receiving a monthly dividend check, that's going to be very hard to take away. So it's got a very strong impact from a durability point of view. And secondly, it's durable because we believe this policy, and we've seen this, can be a bipartisan supported policy. And I think that in order for a policy to be durable at this point, it has to be bipartisan. And thirdly, fairness. We think that the dividend has a significant, well, our study shows that the lower two-thirds of the households from an economic, from an income point of view, either do as well or better with that. So it's also very strong from a fairness point of view.
Okay, good. So, Steve, as you know, others think the money should be reinvested in the economy, into green infrastructure, into clean tech, into rail systems, et cetera. So your perspective on the viability of those ideas is what?
My personal perspective on that is I think that those, you know, that the use of the revenue is going to be, just realistically, is going to be something that's negotiated. Mm-hmm. And I think that there's very real and very legitimate views of how it could be and how it could be used. I certainly would personally find, you know, be supportive of a lot of the things that you just mentioned. Mm-hmm. Our main point of this is we think that this would be optimize the possibility of getting a bill passed.
Okay.
But,
so,
you know, kind of in the sausage making, we like to say, it's not going to come out exactly like this or anybody else's proposal. And I think those will be very worthwhile conversations.
Yeah, great. Yeah, and I think what you'll hear throughout the afternoon is, you know, is an understanding there's a political reality here. And the first objective, I think, is to build support for the broad idea of let's tax something we need less of. And then we can figure out at what price we'll effectuate market change, and then what do we do with the revenue.
Right.
So can I hold you there for a second?
Absolutely.
Okay,
thank you.
Thanks. We'll come back to that. Greg, you have been an influential person on this conversation for the past year and a half now, 2 years, I think, with the Climate Leadership Council, which is an unusual cast of characters. Here is the cast of... Huh? Stop. Okay, good. So This is an effort that former Secretary of State Baker and Schultz have been behind, as well as other senior Republicans. So tell us what has prompted that group of esteemed Republican elder statesmen, and maybe some stateswomen, to gather around this idea that a carbon tax is a national security issue, it will help maybe reduce the deficit, and it'll address climate change.
Sure. Well, thanks again for having me on the panel. I should say, as someone who works for an organization that, among other things, works with businesses to promote carbon pricing, I suspected that the business case for carbon tax event would be something where I agreed with a lot of what was said, and I'm not disappointed. So one thing I wanted to just point out, an area of agreement, was what Harold said in his introduction, which is the Citizens Climate Lobby has done more to advance the conversation on carbon pricing with Congress than any other organization, bar none. And we all owe them a debt of gratitude for the groundwork they've laid over the last decade in this discussion. So any of us who are interested in this getting to the finish line, they have been a critical partner along the way. So thank you all for your work. So I had the pleasure and honor to sit down with Secretary Schultz yesterday, and it's pretty simple for him. He views climate change as the single greatest threat facing humanity, and he thinks that we should do something about it. But even if you are unsure of the link between man-made activity and climate change, I think the way Secretary Baker puts it is quite effective, which is, we know that there are risks, and those risks are great enough that even if you are unsure of the exact link between man's contribution and those future risks, they're great enough that we need to take out an insurance policy. And so that's why these two gentlemen ultimately came together to develop the plan that we call the Baker-Schultz plan, which actually looks very similar to the Citizens Climate Lobby, with a few key differences. But fundamentally, that's why they started the effort. But the second reason is it's consistent with their political beliefs. A carbon price, carbon tax, a carbon dividends program is conservative in nature. It is market-based. It would reduce the role of government. And this is something that both parties want. It would be effective. It would be effective at addressing the underlying issue of the policy, which is to lower emissions. And then the third reason is they see what's happening with the American public and what's happening within their own party. And later today, there'll be a representative from the Students for Carbon Dividends, Kira, who runs that organization, who will tell you they are struggling, and she runs the Republican Club at Harvard, they're struggling to attract new members to the organization because of the Republican Party's lack of stance on climate. And this is backed up by all of the polling that we've all seen, which is the majority of the public wants their government to do more to address climate, somewhere in the neighborhood of 2/3 of all voters. But when you break that down by age group, it's somewhere around 80% of millennials, and then it drops about 10% each year until you get to about 50% or so for voters 65 years and older. And any pollster will tell you, Republican or Democrat, that the next wave of voters are going to vote a lot more like their older brother and sister millennials than they are their grandparents. So to the extent the Republican Party wants to remain relevant with this voting bloc, it's time to come to the table, it's time to have a position, and that's what Secretaries Baker and Schultz have offered.
Good. And let me, those who have the note cards, the runners, if you could distribute those, and if you have questions, jot them down and bring them on up. So, Greg, the companies that have signed up for your program, and if you could just quickly sketch out the key principles of that program, what has motivated BP and these other large oil, energy companies in particular, to endorse this idea of a carbon tax?
Sure. Frankly, for most of these companies, this is a position they've held for many years. And what I believe appeals most to them, Steve did a nice job of laying out what the benefits of the dividend piece of the puzzle are. And I should say, our proposal has a fourth pillar, which is a regulatory simplification pillar. So for regulations that are essentially impacted by the carbon price, you would be able to pull those back. And of course, that's an interest to businesses who are regulated. But ultimately, as we've shown time and time again, and economists across the political spectrum have shown time and time again, that's a winning trade to make, and it's not even really close. So if you're motivated or brought to this discussion by an interest in climate, which I think many of the folks in the room are, you need a policy that has longevity, it's a long-term problem that needs a long-term solution. And we believe the dividend is the greatest way to ensure that the policy stays in place long-term. If you are brought to this discussion by an interest, at least to some degree, in creating some regulatory and policy certainty for your business, we believe the dividend provides the greatest possibility for that long-term certainty. Because if the policy does not stay in place, you don't get the long-term reductions, but you also don't get the long-term regulatory and policy certainty. So I think the combination of the four interconnected pillars that Baker and Schultz have proposed has been what's really brought the people to the table, brought these companies to this discussion.
Good. Thank you, Greg. And we'll return to that. Let me turn to Alex. And if there are questions, I'd be happy to have them in my hand and sort through them now while we're. So Alex, I know, thank you. I know that you've thought about this. Also, thanks from a conservative perspective, and that when we were talking on the phone, you suggested that climate change is a environmental imperative. It's an imperative to deal with to preserve the planet's quality of life. But there's also a fiscal driver here. And you said that it's as important that a carbon tax would help address not only the environmental problem, but the country's fiscal challenges. So tell us about that.
Yeah, so let me talk about this from a conservative perspective. So AMS is a group of Republican business leaders who believe we have to address climate change. So that's enough for the cocktail party reception this evening, right? But what we believe is that a carbon tax is the right way to achieve it because it reduces carbon pollution so much more efficiently than any other sort of regulation. There are a lot of conservative perspective on that. By the way, one of my board members who ran State Farm for 30 years has an op-ed in the New York Times today, an insurance executive's perspective on why we need a carbon tax for one of them. And so there's a whole set of justifications for a carbon tax on the climate side of the equation, but frankly, we think the fiscal issues are going to be an equal or greater driver for carbon tax policy. And I want to just give you some primers on some things. So first of all, the federal government collects about $4 trillion a year in taxes. It spends $5 trillion. That's why we have $1 trillion a year, a 20% deficit every year. We're at a $21 trillion debt. That is forecast to grow at least $1 trillion a year indefinitely. The first chart. We have five federal trust funds that go insolvent between 2025 and 2032. So you all know Social Security, but it's Social Security retirement plus Social Security disability. It's the highway trust fund, it's the multi-employer pension insurance fund, and it's Medicare. All go insolvent in that period of time. Also, by the way, 2025 is the year in which the current lower personal income tax rates expire. So income tax rates will go up in that period of time. And just for when I talk to Republican policymakers, sometimes billions and trillions get confused. So let me show you the next slide very quickly. Well, it's true. It really is interesting. So this is a chart because I think so. A reasonable carbon tax raises between $1 and $2 trillion over 10 years, and that's the window that Congress keeps track of, 10-year tax figures. So what I did was I went to the Joint Tax Committee and I took the list of all of the potential tax revenue raisers over 10 years that raise more than $1 trillion. So when you think about the politics associated with the carbon tax, compare it to the politics, I'm going to start at the bottom of the chart. It's more money than getting rid of the home interest mortgage deduction. It raises more money than getting rid of the state and local income tax deduction. It gets rid of more, it raises more money than getting rid of the capital gains tax rate. So when people tell you the politics of a carbon tax are complex, think about the fiscal environment where we have these real fiscal challenges coming towards us, the potential to raise revenue to make it possible to avoid other tax increases, possibility of maintaining the tax rates as they currently are, paying to make the tax cuts permanent, et cetera. Our contention is that a carbon tax, which is the right policy to address climate change, needs to also be considered as a fiscal policy issue. And because of some of the dates we have coming up, those are going to be more powerful drivers for implementing a carbon tax than the climate justification, even though the climate justification is as strong as it is. And so what that tells us from a tactical perspective is, when we go to Capitol Hill, we don't tell policymakers what to do with the carbon tax revenues. We don't propose that they use it for anything particular. When we talk to the people who are aware of the fiscal challenges that we have coming on, they already know what to do with the revenue from a carbon tax. And we think those issues are going to push it through the legislative process as fast, if not faster, than the need to address carbon pollution.
Thank you. I'm glad to see this audience has no interest in this topic at all. It's good. So one of the questions, Alex, people have been asking is, how critical is it to set a price at a high enough threshold that creates behavioral change? And what is that price? Is that $15 a ton, goes up $10 a ton?
Right.
Do you start it at 80? Do you start it at what level?
So the answer is, in order to address the climate issue, you have to set the carbon tax at a price that affects behavior. That price is fairly significant. I think reasonable people suggest $25+ going up over time. I will tell you that the modeling that we do says that that price varies depending upon the rate of growth in the economy in the United States and around the world, so there's a lot of variations. But a reasonable carbon tax, for example, the modelers that we use generally plug in somewhere between $25 and $50 a ton. I think what's more complex actually is, will policymakers want to impose the same cost across all sectors in the economy? What are they going to do in utilities? What are they going to do in transportation? What are they going to do in airlines and manufacturing and other things? How are they going to deal with the border issues that arise? And so our view is, it's got to be a legitimate price so that it sends a signal to the market, and the policymakers are going to figure out the details of exactly what
okay.
that is.
Okay, yeah. Greg, let me ask, because there are a number of questions about regulatory relief. And I know in meetings I've been to, particularly at Brookings Institution, it seems to be a bit of a deal breaker for the environmental community when we start talking about regulatory relief and doing away with the Clean Power Plan and other and emissions and methane controls, et cetera, et cetera. So when you speak about regulatory relief, what are you particularly suggesting we could do differently?
So the starting premise is that it's a one-for-one trade. So if the activity is being affected by the carbon price, that would provide a justification for rolling back the regulation. So for example, in the Baker-Schultz proposal, the tax applies to carbon emissions, does not, at least in its current form, apply to methane emissions. So we would not, in that situation, propose rolling back the methane regulations. But the other response I would have is, let's look back at how the regulatory approach has worked from an environmental perspective. We had the bulk of the second term of the Obama administration spent on crafting the Clean Power Plan, which a variety of views on. But one thing that's clear is that Clean Power Plan is not in place today, and so let's follow that path for a second. So we've got now the Trump approach, which is a much slimmer version of the utility rule. Well, you can imagine what will happen the next time there's a Democrat in the White House, which is they'll probably start going down the Obama path again. But at some point, there'll be a future Republican or a future administration that probably disagrees with that approach and will swing back the other way. And at the end of the day, what you're left with is a lose-lose. It's a lose for the environment because the rules never actually get implemented so that they drive the necessary reductions. And it's a lose for businesses because they never know what the rules of the game are. They never know what the policies are going to be more than 2 or 3 years down the road. So while I understand there's some concern about the concept of pulling back some of the regulatory authority of the agencies, at the end of the day, if we're driving 2 times or 3 times the emission reductions of those policies, if they were to actually get implemented, which again, they haven't yet, we think that would be an unquestioned winning trade. So that's the justification in our mind, and it's pretty compelling for making that trade.
Helen, there are a few questions about the redistributive nature of a carbon tax and whether the $15 a ton or $35 a ton per the tax, as it filters through the economy, will likely raise the price of gasoline, will raise the price of bread, electricity, et cetera. How do low-income communities and people with limited means deal with that scenario?
It's an excellent question. And let me give you an example from British Columbia, just a bit north of us here, because it depends very much on how those revenues are used and how the carbon tax is applied. British Columbia put in place a carbon tax in 2008, and they started low at about 10 Canadian dollars per ton and then increased it over time. And they've just agreed last year that they're going to continue to increase it. So they've got another sort of a nice predictable path for industry and business and consumers to adjust to that carbon price. They've got that clear signal going through. So they actually have raised quite significant revenues through the carbon tax. In 2015-16, it was about 1.2 billion Canadian dollars. And a lot of that has been recycled back to households or to businesses through tax reductions, tax cuts, whether these are tax credits on personal income or reductions in property tax, et cetera. Now, they recently did a study looking at what were the impacts on different parts of the economy from those measures of recycling that tax. And what they found is the low-income and the middle-income households were actually better off because of the carbon tax than they would have been without the carbon tax. So they actually were doing better off at a household level because of the way the recycling of the revenues was taken. So it really depends how you do this and how you apply it, the mechanisms that you use, and understanding how that filters through the economy to different households. But they have done that. A number of other countries or economies have done so as well and found similar results, but it depends on the priorities. So, I mean, we had Ireland. Ireland was in a very different spot. In 2008, they put in place a carbon price, and they did this as they were facing the outcomes of the financial crisis. So they had a choice to be made. They were facing very stringent and strict fiscal tightening, some austerity measures there. They put in place the carbon price, were able to actually get enough revenues that they didn't have to take some of those austerity measures on in the economy, which was their priority at that time. So you have very different examples from around the world. And what we're seeing now, which is exciting, is some of the actual analysis of results of how these have worked in practice on the ground. But certainly in terms of the low-income households, that's something which can be and has been dealt with successfully in a number of cases.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. this is a conversation I think that could go on for a while, but we have to cut it off here in a few minutes quickly. but there are a number of questions for Greg and Alex that are suspicious of Republican interest in this issue and wonder what will it take to get the Republican leadership in Congress really on board, and is this a sincere effort? And your two organizations are obviously working hard. But, you know, is this real? Does Senator McConnell really care about this? And, you know, outgoing Speaker Ryan, is this a priority? And how do we generate more interest in the Republican Party? Which of you would? Alex?
How long do we have?
Thank you.
When I talk to Republican policymakers, I've talked to over 70 in the last year. I've had one deny climate change. The rest of them have accepted it and been afraid of the politics, and that's what has to change. They have to be convinced that the politics for them, it's why we do surveys and polls in their individual districts and try to identify places where the politics can be supportive. The other point is younger Republicans are there already. This is a question about, remember, they're politicians. We have to make the politics right for them, and they are scared. And I'll save the rest for when I've got more time.
Okay, do good. Thank you, Alex. Greg, anything to add to that?
Well said.
Okay, good.
But is it real? We're proposing a $40 a ton carbon price, which would be the highest carbon price of any major nation in the world. Yeah, it's a serious policy.
Good. And then, Helen, let me just end with you with a quick summation, if you could. When you think about policy design and the complexity of taking all these factors into account, what are some guiding principles that elected officials have to consider here?
I would say one of the most critical is actually understanding the multiple benefits of carbon pricing. I mean, we do find, we've had a new report of the Global Commission on Economy and Climate last week, found real net economic benefits from putting carbon pricing in place. You have a number of different design choices, and we've discussed here particularly how to use the revenues. Depending what the public priorities are, what the politics are, you have ways that you can actually achieve real benefits, not just to the economy, for innovation, in terms of social outcomes, in terms of employment generation. So put it in place now, price it well, and get moving.
Good, thank you. Okay. Thank you all, appreciate your time, and why don't we have our next panel come up. Good, thanks, Helen.
Is this working? Hey, everybody. How are you doing today? Thank you, Richard. Thank you, BCL, for organizing this event. Harold, thank you for your kind remarks about Future 500 earlier. And thanks to all of you in the audience for joining us today. There is a ton going on this week at GECAS, and you are all very nice to share your time here to have fun with us. So again, appreciate you being here. Before diving in, I want to take a quick poll, see who's in the room. So, who here in the room is from the nonprofit sector? CCLers, don't raise your hand. All right, pretty good representation of my sector. Government, any folks from government? All right, good. How about investors or philanthropists? Good. And corporates? Good. All right, some of the panelists didn't raise their hand. So I'm Eric Wolgemuth, I'm the COO of Future 500. We're a service-based nonprofit that builds trust between corporations, advocates, investors, and philanthropists to advance business as a force for good. Our opening panel that you just heard, it was great, covered carbon pricing mechanisms and different strategies for using the money generated. Our panel is going to focus on what the business community thinks about this, as we know that business, particularly big companies, are a great determinant of policy outcomes, particularly here in the United States. The five of you here are leaders from notable companies who are addressing the risk of climate change in various ways, from internal carbon pricing, leveraging your procurement power to drive it through the supply chain, and through your legislative advocacy. We're going to want to explore what motivates your leadership to mitigate carbon emissions, and how do you integrate carbon considerations into your business strategy, and what is motivating or would motivate your company to support different carbon pricing policies. So I'm going to start with Christina. First off, thank you for hosting us today. Appreciate it.
Great. Well, I'd just like to welcome all of you on behalf of Gap Inc. to this really important conversation and really powerful week here that we're hosting in San Francisco as part of the Global Climate Action Summit. So, thank you.
Great. So, Christina, what factors are motivating big brands like retailers and Gap to find ways to reduce your GHG emissions? Is it consumer expectations, investor pressure, the Fisher family? What's really motivating you right now?
Well, I'd say actually all of the above, but we really see addressing climate change as benefiting our business by making us not only more efficient and reducing our emissions, we become part of something bigger, and that's really solving this really important problem. Businesses, we believe, play an absolutely critical role in this conversation. And as Michelle mentioned during her welcome this morning, we've set a 50% absolute GHG reduction goal for our owned and operated facilities globally. And we are not only working towards achieving those goals, but as part of it, we're adding renewable energy to the grid, which I think is another really important part of this conversation. She also mentioned that last fall, signed up for joined the Science Based Target Initiative and signed up to actually set a scope 3 emissions for our supply chain to really address that aspect of our impact. I think on the advocacy side, we're active members of Ceres and BICEP. We also joined the We Are Still In Coalition, which is over 300 members strong, and that includes cities, states, academic institutions, NGOs like yourself, as well as businesses, to really stand up and say, you know, we are still in and still support the Paris Agreement, even though the U.S. has pulled out.
And how about that effort to try to drive it through the supply chain? What are your big conundrums there and challenges?
Well, as with scope 3 emissions, we don't have direct control, similar to how we have control of our owned and operated facilities. We can make decisions that not only make good business sense, but also reduce that impact. I think with the supply chain, it's a little bit more complex, and we're really taking our time to be specific, considered, and set that baseline and really set a target that we know we can achieve in partnership with the several suppliers we work with globally.
Great, thank you. David, Exelon was a founding member of the Climate Leadership Council, so I want to hear a little bit more about what motivated you to do this and why support a carbon dividend approach versus other policies.
Sure, and let me just give you a quick Exelon 101 so you know where we're coming from. We're a public utility holding company headquartered in Chicago. We have traditional utilities in Chicago, Philadelphia, Baltimore, and our most recent addition was Pepco in Washington, D.C. So we've got traditional utility side, we've got a retail wholesale competitive supplier in Constellation, and then we're the largest generator of clean energy in the country by a factor of 2. We do that with a combination of nuclear power, wind, solar, hydro, and some natural gas as well. So really, if you go back to the founding, the creation of Exelon in 2000 with the merger of Commonwealth Edison and PECO Energy, carbon was one of the drivers from the very start. That merger brought together two of the largest nuclear utilities in the country, and we didn't get there by accident. It was a concerted decision. When John Rowe, one of our original chairmen, went to Commonwealth Edison, he was faced with a choice between investing in 10,000 megawatts of coal assets that ComEd had and selling the nuclear, or selling the nuclear and plowing it into the coal. And he opted to get rid of the coal units, even though he had come from New England, and plow the proceeds into improving our nuclear output. And he took that fleet from about a 60% capacity factor to today, it's over 92-93%. It's one of the best performing nuclear fleets in the world. And so these are just enormous machines that produce tons of carbon-free energy. Nuclear in the U.S. is about 20% of the energy mix, but 60% of the clean energy in the nation. So for us, this has been something that we've cared about since our founding. We were active in U.S. CAP. We were active supporters of Waxman-Markey. And so joining the CLC was kind of a no-brainer for us. John Rowe, who I mentioned earlier, first actually testified before Congress in a previous capacity in 1992, calling for a carbon tax. And then that advocacy kind of went dormant as we looked at cap and trade and other solutions, but I think we've kind of come full circle. And one of the reasons that we prefer the dividend is, as Greg said, it goes to the sustainability of the program and make sure that it'll be around and won't be subject to the political changes in Washington. And the other thing, frankly, is given our customer base, when you look at Chicago, Philadelphia, Baltimore, and D.C., we care a lot about the regressive impacts of a tax. And so if you look at the dividend return proposal, about 70% of Americans, over 70% of Americans, are better off under a dividend proposal than any other proposal.
Great, thank you. Mary Ellen, you and I had a delightful dinner a little over a year ago, and it touched on Steelcase's evolving carbon strategy. So, you know, you're part of RE100, you're big advocates of renewable energy, and I'm curious since that dinner, what factors are motivating Steelcase to reduce its GHG emissions? Give us a little insight into what's going on in your company.
Okay, thanks, Eric. And I want to thank Christina and Gap Inc. for hosting us, and also Harold and Steve for encouraging my participation here. So just a little bit of background information first. So I represent Steelcase, which is a global leader in the office furniture industry. And we're all about trying to transform work, workers, and workplace. And basically, the only way we can do that is by adding value for our customers and our stakeholders. And with that, you might wonder, why would I possibly be participating in a carbon tax forum? And the way we think of it is, it's a long-term game. We need more certainty. We need to be able to plan for the future. It's not a good situation for a business to be surprised. So we would much rather put up with the possibility of cost increases or taxes if we are well aware of them and can actually plan for them. So in terms of our commitment to greenhouse gas emission reductions, so as Eric said, we're a member of RE100, so we've committed to 100% renewable electricity for our electricity usage around the world. And that was a couple of years ago. We're committed to doing that on into the future. And we're also in the process of starting to look at setting science-based targets to make sure that for the future, our greenhouse gas emissions are in line with what would keep us, hopefully, as a world and nation below that 2 degrees Celsius increase mark.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Nick, you Exxon has actually implemented an internal carbon price several years ago. And several other companies have followed suit. So I'm curious about what impact that's had kind of on your investment decisions over the years and what might be the impact of a national carbon tax both on the oil and gas sector and on ExxonMobil writ large.
Thanks, Eric. It's good to be here today. Thank you to The Gap for hosting us in this lovely room. I hope I speak for everybody in the room that we're looking forward to seeing whatever chum you have available. We've got... The air is getting crisp, and my fall wardrobe really needs an upgrade, so thank you for hosting us.
Bring on the questions, everybody.
And thanks to Citizens Climate Lobby. I've had the good fortune of participating in a few Citizens Climate Lobby events on the East Coast, so it's nice to see some old friends here here in San Francisco. So to your question about the carbon price, just to give people a little understanding of how we look at this, we have an annual business planning basis that we do every year that's global in scope, which actually ladders up to a publication that we put out every year called our Energy Outlook, which I encourage people to just take a look at. And what this planning process is designed to do is to give us, as a company that makes investments that are very long-lived, that can play out over 20, 30, 40 years, confidence in the decisions that we're making, in the investment decisions that we're making. And so as we do that, we look around the world, and for some time, I thought the earlier panel was terrific, the chart that was shown, you see what's going on around the world. So I think the original map went back to 2008. There wasn't a lot of carbon pricing globally. It was just in a few regions. You fast forward to today, and you see there's carbon pricing in much of the world, and I don't think that's going to change. I think that's you're going to accelerate that. So for our business planning purposes, we assume a proxy price of carbon in different regions. Now, it'll differ, say, in Europe as opposed to sub-Saharan Africa. But we impose that proxy cost on our business planning decisions so that we understand what might the effect be on demand. I mean, that's really what we're talking about here. Carbon prices, whether it's in the form of a carbon tax or cap and trade, or, you know, a properly designed cap and trade program, will have an effect on demand for products. And it could have a dampening demand on for our products right now. It could have elevate demand for David's products. So we do that, and that's what guides our investment decisions all around the world. That's how we look at it.
Great, thank you. Chris, so you're based in California, obviously. You've had a lot of experience with the state's cap and trade program, and how's that working for you?
Sure. Well, good afternoon, everybody. It's great to be here, and this really is an exciting week. It's amazing how many events are happening all over the city and around climate action. So I'm Chris Benjamin. I lead the sustainability team at PG&E, headquartered just around the corner from here today. I think I had probably one of the shortest commutes. And we provide clean energy to about 16 million people throughout Northern and Central California. And, you know, as a company, you know, our sustainability journey is really linked with California's. And we're really privileged to serve customers in California, which, as many of you know, has some of the nation's most progressive climate and energy policies, including a goal to reduce emissions 40% by 2030 from a 1990 baseline, with really aggressive goals around renewable energy, zero-emission vehicles, energy efficiency, et cetera. And the utilities in California are really partners with the state in helping to achieve those goals. And the state, as Eric mentioned, as part of that sort of portfolio of programs, also has a cap and trade program, which has been in place here since 2013. And it was actually recently extended to 2030, which we actively supported. And so we participate in that program, which sets a cap on the state's emissions that declines over time, and companies like ours have some flexibility in terms of meeting our compliance obligation through reducing emissions or purchasing allowances in the carbon market or for a certain portion, carbon offsets. And the program is working, and I think it's just a great example of how you can put a price on carbon. And what we've seen in the state of California is we have reduced the state's greenhouse gas emissions over time while the economy has continued to grow through a variety of different measures. And I think it's also helped attract a lot of investment here in the state in terms of low carbon technologies, which is a really important, I think, part of the story in terms of putting a price on carbon. So there's really, I think I just agree with all the other panelists, is that there's a really strong business case for doing this. One of the features of the program also is use of the proceeds, you know, that are collected, which last year I think topped $700 million. And those are supporting a variety of low carbon technologies throughout the state, including rebates for purchasing electric vehicles and plug-in electric vehicles, which is really, really important because as a state, about 40% of our greenhouse gas emissions come from the transportation sector. So that's a really important focus for our company and many others, is how do we transform, you know, that sector and get more electric vehicles driving on California's roads.
Quick follow-up there. SB 100 passed last week by the California legislature, commits the state to go to 100% fossil fuel-free electricity by 2045. Hope that wasn't a surprise to you. I figured you were involved in some of the making of that. So could you talk a little bit about how that's going to impact you going forward?
Sure, absolutely. You know, it's a really important piece of legislation. And as I mentioned, you know, we've long supported California's efforts around reducing emissions and bringing more clean energy to our customers. In fact, last year, we actually hit 33% renewable energy for our customers. Actually, that's 3 years ahead of schedule for the state. And so we look forward to doing even more for our customers. During the legislative process, we did express some just concerns about the maintaining the affordability of this for our customers. And I think that's just really important, is as we make this transition and transform our economy to meet the challenge of climate change, how do we do so and make sure we do so in an affordable way for everyone involved?
Got it. Later today, we're going to hear a brief video from Congressman Curbelo and his proposal, and I know that Gap was one of the companies, I think, that signed onto a letter encouraging the congressman for seeking bipartisan agreement on addressing carbon risk or climate risk. So I'm curious, why? What is it about that particular approach that you wanted to praise publicly?
Well, I think it's in line with our policy advocacy and our work with the Ceres and Bicep Coalition. We also support bipartisan activity on this topic, and we felt that supporting Curbelo made a lot of sense for us. I think it's important where we can to step up and use that business voice to really add some wind to the sails.
Chris, you signed on to it as well.
Yeah, Chris. Yeah, we did. And maybe just segueing there, we've got a really successful program here in the state of California. We've also, like many of the panelists here, I think just long supported the need for a federal, greenhouse gas reduction program. And, the way we think about it is in terms of principles, around a carbon pricing program, doing so in a way that is multi-sector, so not just the utility sector, but across the different sectors of the economy, one that prioritizes, as I mentioned earlier, the affordability and the impacts to customers, and also harmonizing a national program with successful programs like the one we have here in the state of California. And we did sign on and joined a coalition of a number of other companies around the Congressman Curbelo's recent legislation, which we think is a really positive step in the right direction. And I think it's helping, along with a number of other activities, including from the folks in this room, to get the conversation moving and get the dialogue moving around how do we get some traction at the national level.
Eric, if I could just add something on the Curbelo bill. I understand he's speaking here later today, maybe by video, I don't know if he's gonna be here in person, but I encourage everybody here to listen to him, because he's a good example of what Greg was talking about in the earlier panel about some of the generational differences with respect to this issue. He's a younger member, he's a very sharp guy, he's very conservative. So there are things that are changing, I think, on the right side of the aisle. And so I just encourage you to, if you have time and you get to hear him today, to listen to what he has to say.
Got it. Hey, Mary Ellen, one thing I want to touch on, we're talking about some of the national carbon prices, and you mentioned earlier how you're feeling your way toward it. Are there particular things about a national policy that you think could really motivate your leadership? And if investors or your customers really began to put more pressure on you, do you think that would be one of the things that could motivate you to get on board with a particular policy?
Yes, I think certainly the fact that our customers are members of the Climate Leadership Coalition makes a difference, and I think our customers like us are also asking for more certainty, more predictability. But in terms of a potential national carbon fee or carbon tax, what's important to us is to have as broad of a scope geographically as possible. It's very difficult when we're dealing with regulatory requirements that differ not only from state to state and, of course, country to country, but even from different municipalities to others. It becomes very expensive to deal with all of that variation in regulatory requirements. So yes, if there were to be a carbon fee or carbon tax, we would certainly hope that it would be applied nationally with the border adjustments and the other aspects that have been described.
Great. A lot of questions here. Thank you, everybody. Can you hear me? Sorry. A lot of questions. One is on cap and trade, which has strong constituencies both in California and the EU. I think this is a question for David and or Chris. And can that be overcome in favor of carbon taxation? I think there's some deliberation on what's the right policy for some folks, and I know CCL is very supportive of the carbon tax approach. Can you comment a little bit on that?
Sure. Well, it's ironic that cap and trade, which was a Republican idea, has been poisoned as cap and tax by Republicans in recent years. I think it's very workable. I think you have the same problem with the revenue side on taxes that you have with allowances on cap and trade programs, discussions about how to return those or allocate those allowances. I think it's definitely doable, but I think that a tax at this point just seems much more efficient, mm-hmm. easier to administer, and gives you different options to protect the customer classes that are out there. So, if we could go back to cap and tax and use the Clean Air Act as a success story, where everybody in the industry achieved the targets faster than anybody anticipated and much cheaper than anybody anticipated, that'd be a great way to go. But don't see that on the horizon.
Got it. And the only thing I would say is that you know, we support carbon pricing, and there's different ways of getting there, whether it's cap and trade or a carbon tax. If it's designed in the right way, you know, with some of the principles that we've been talking about, then it can achieve the ultimate goal of reducing emissions and doing it in a cost-effective way.
Great. So Nick, as you anticipated, there's been a lot of questions for Exxon, so I'm going to try to harmonize a few of them. And as you know, we work with a lot of companies to advance their sustainability strategies in alignment with stakeholder expectations. And one of the biggest challenges we see companies face is aligning tone and deed. And Exxon's been very public over a number of years talking about the need for a carbon tax. But I think a lot of your critics and your skeptics don't see the actions or the deeds aligning with that tone. And so I'm curious if you can comment on that. In the last year, there has been a notable change. You pulled out of ALEC. The current CEO has been a lot more vocal about the carbon issues than his predecessor. You joined the Climate Leadership Council. So what is different, if there is something different going on inside? What's going on in the Temple of Doom?
So come and visit and find out. So I wouldn't say that there's anything categorically different. What I do think our company has a differentiated approach on this issue in some ways, especially compared with our peer companies or competitor companies, which I actually think is appropriate, because I think if you look at this problem and you look at this challenge and the global nature of it and the scale challenges involved, I don't think there's one single approach that's actually going to that's the only approach. Where we have chosen to focus our efforts primarily has been, and maybe it's less visible to some people, but has been in some of the longer range technology challenges. We actually see this climate change being meaningfully addressed with some with technologies that don't even exist yet. The current suite of current generation of technologies is not going to be adequate given the increase in global demand around the world that we can reasonably expect. And given the scale challenges involved. I mean, just a couple of numbers to keep in mind. Between now and mid-century, you're going to have 3 billion people around the world who are rising into the middle class. And it's the middle class, global middle class, that is the driver of consumption and emissions. You have 2 billion people around the world today who cannot, who don't use modern cooking facilities to cook their food. They use things like animal dung, for example. There are over 1 billion people around the world who don't have access to electricity. So these are the numbers that we need to think about when we're talking about the scale of the challenge globally, not in places like California where we already have all of these things, where we have a modern economy and all the benefits of modernity. But we need to think globally about this. And so we have been focusing on long-range technology development in a number of areas because we think these are going to be the technologies that are going to be needed. On the flip side, on the policy front, I mean, as you mentioned, we've articulated support for carbon tax as the best approach on this. And I want to pick up on a couple of comments that some of the other panelists made. David pointed out that carbon tax is probably more efficient than cap and trade. And that's not an insignificant point, because the costs involved are going to matter for the willingness of countries and societies to accept the costs to transition their energy mix, their fuel mix, and all the rest. We don't have infinite resources around the world. So efficiency in policy is actually extremely important. And one thing maybe we'll get a chance to talk about is there's a lot of policy in place nationally, at the state level, regionally, and I think we should spend some more time thinking about, okay, is this optimal policy? Is this the right way of going about addressing this challenge? Because if you have policies in place that are very, very high cost, for example, but very low benefit, it might feel as if we're doing something about this challenge, but in reality we're not, or we're not doing enough. And so focusing on the importance of efficient policy is actually pretty critical. And so when we look at the suite of available policy approaches, that's why we have for a decade now supported a carbon tax as the most appropriate means of dealing with this.
Got it. A lot of questions coming in here. A few questions about nuclear, so I'm going to pivot back to David, and just in terms of some of the risks of dealing with the waste, some of the classic issues, people are concerned about that. They don't really think of it as clean energy, even though you defined it that way. So if you could touch on some of address some of the concerns that
sure.
the audience have.
Yeah, look, absolutely. Every technology's got its benefits and its disadvantages. Nuclear does have a waste stream, but unlike other energy sources, I can tell you where every single gram of used nuclear fuel that's ever been created in the United States is. It's not in the ground, it's not in the air, it's not in the water, it's inside the reactors. Dealing with this on a long-term basis is not a technical challenge. It's a political problem, and we shouldn't underestimate that, but it's not a technical problem. We know how to deal with this, and other countries around the world are dealing with this as well. Some might argue that the U.S. focus has been a little too narrow, but there are a lot of options out there, and so yes, we've got a waste stream, but again, I think the distinguishing factor is that I can tell you where every bit of that waste is at this point. And I think getting back to the efficiency point, you know, MIT just put out a study, the power sector, last week, that said if we focus on the result, on eliminating carbon, we will get there faster and cheaper than if we try to dictate what technologies we use to get there. So whether it's nuclear, wind, solar, geothermal, whatever it might be, if we focus on the end result that we all want, which is a carbon-free power generation sector, we can get there faster than if we try to dictate how we get there.
So a few questions on, how each of you are dealing with financial reporting and increasing investor demands on ESG. This question was specifically posed to the Gap, so I'll turn it over to you, Christina, in terms of how important is this to some of your investors nowadays?
Sure. As part of the Series Network, 50% approximately are businesses and 50% are investors. And so we got a lot of investor insight through that relationship. I think one of the key signals that we've seen from investors is through the updated questionnaire. As part of the Climate Disclosure Project, we fill out that report every year. And one of the things that was new this year and that actually will likely lose points on is around financial modeling for climate-related risks. And I think we're not the only business that is going to have and face that challenge as we think about changing climate. We're a global company. A lot of where we source from could potentially be more impacted. We're a cotton-based company. And so when you think about the challenges of growing that cotton and the water used to grow that cotton, I think the risk related to climate is pretty big for our business, and we take it very seriously. And certainly are encouraged by the intelligent questions that investors are starting to ask.
Do you want to comment a little bit on some of the negotiations you've been having with investors on some of your reporting? I know that it's been a challenge to ExxonMobil to kind of move forward with that after the resolution. So I'm curious how that's been working for you folks internally with some of your engagement with investors.
So sure, we there's increasing shareholder interest in this subject. Period. I mean, there's no doubt, and I think that's true for every country, company, not just in our sector, but you see it even in companies where you wouldn't necessarily immediately think about climate change at the Gap. We had a shareholder proposal that passed, which was asking us for additional disclosures in this space. Sensitivity analyses, looking at things like what might stepped-up adoption of electric vehicles mean for demand for your products, for example, and things like that. And I think it's appropriate that investors are asking those questions. We found over the course of the last year, meeting with shareholders both in the U.S. and around the world, after we put out our energy and carbon summary, which is on our website, and I encourage you to take a look at it. We've had a very constructive series of dialogues with them. It's actually informing how we will be doing additional disclosures in the future. The disclosures are very, for those of you in the business community, you know this, but some folks may not be quite as attuned to some of the challenges there. It's a deeply regulated space, and so companies have to be very careful in what they say and how they say it. And so one of the things that we've been trying to do more of It's partly just a resourcing issue, is just more one-on-one time with investors in the U.S. and around the world, both to hear from them what their concerns are about challenges and, quite frankly, opportunities for our company and the industry as it addresses climate change risks. We found that those kinds of engagements are actually quite constructive, and again, they feed into how we talk to investors about it, how we think about how we plan our business, and how we're thinking about the future.
If I could just briefly add, I think this is a really, really important topic, and like The Gap and others, we've been reporting to the CDP and others for a long time, and there's a lot of value in doing that, because through that disclosure process, you learn a lot about your company. Where are the gaps? Where are the opportunities? And so it becomes just part of built into your program. We're also we're seeing the effects of climate change today. We're seeing it in California after years of drought, extreme precipitation, heat waves, of course, the wildfires. And so we've been doing a lot there as well, vulnerability assessments, trying to assess the risks of the effects of climate change, on our assets, on our infrastructure, so that we can better plan for the future. And I think a positive development is within our industry, one of our associations, EEI, is actually helping to coordinate an effort across utilities to provide information to investors. And it's been a really positive dialogue to better understand the type of metrics and qualitative information they're looking for, developing some templates so that we're providing information in a more standardized way, so it's easier for them to find the information that they're looking for, and it's just been a really positive development.
A lot of questions around future demand and Exxon's energy outlook projecting a 25% increase in oil and gas sales over the next 20 years, and so one of the questions is how effective, and maybe the policy folks here on the panel can talk about this, how effective will a tax be on really reducing emissions and driving down demand for carbon-intensive energy, given some of the projections that you put out there?
Well, I think to answer that question, I think we need to be sort of level set about the realities of energy transitions, right? I mean, there have been energy transitions or evolutions in the past. The energy system is always evolving. It usually happens, it doesn't happen overnight. So when our company is looking out at future demand scenarios, and we see demand rising, we're right in the middle of our forecast with whether it's other companies or the International Energy Agency or the U.S. government. So it's not, I think there's a temptation on some to say, well, of course, ExxonMobil would say that because that's what they sell, but you don't have to take our word for it. You can look at other third parties are saying about increased demand. A carbon tax certainly would have an effect on demand, and the questions around it become fundamentally sort of political questions, which is there are lots of products that there are no easy immediate substitutes for, right? So if you own a gasoline vehicle, you might not be able to immediately go and buy an electric vehicle overnight, but the fleet may change and shift over time. Or look at fuel sources for electricity generation. Maybe coal starts to get backed out a little more quickly, and it goes to nuclear or to natural gas or more renewables or whatever it may be. But these are not sort of overnight. This is not a problem that's going to be solved overnight. As somebody on the previous panel mentioned, this is a long-term problem that requires solutions that can unfold over time. But the important point about the tax or putting the tax in place is, as some other folks have mentioned, is it builds uncertainty for business planning purposes. With respect to the point that Greg was making about if you have a dividend, then maybe you get additional certainty that a regulatory regime wouldn't have. And again, businesses can get very frustrated when they're trying to plan long term, but they might not know 2 years, 4 years, 6 years, what the policy regime is going to look like. So having a clear signal, which right now I would argue there is a national carbon tax or a price on emissions. We don't really know what it is though, because we have this sort of patchwork quilt of regulations, policies, both regionally, federal, and state. Having a clear signal would be advantageous to everybody for planning purposes and for technology adoption going forward.
Telling me we're almost out of time? Okay, got it. So there's some questions about, for all the companies, really around lobbying and when. How are you weighing in on policy advocacy and at the federal level? Obviously, there's nothing to be voted on right now, but there's a real sense of the long game here. And how do you step out individually from associations and really make your presence known on the Hill? And so I don't know who would like to field that question first, but there were two or three different questions related to that.
Having flown in from Washington this morning, maybe I'll start with that one. We've been members of several groups, as I said, USCAP, the Clean Energy Group prior to that, and now CLC. I think we've got a lot of education to do, and this is not going to be a near-term game, but we are meeting frequently with Senate offices in particular, Senate Republican offices in particular, and we'll continue to do that. And really, for the first time, Exelon stepped up earlier this year to support a 501c4, Americans for Carbon Dividends. We made $1 million investment in that effort that's affiliated with CLC to really put some additional impetus behind that project. And so we have senators, former Senators Breaux and Lott, working with us on that effort. And so it's not just the individual companies, but we've got the 501c4 behind us as well, working on strategic political activities too.
Anyone else want to comment?
Sure, I'd like to comment. So as part of the Global Sustainability and Foundation, our government affairs team actually sits in the same department. And so we work very, very closely with our government affairs team, not only on climate advocacy, but also other federal and state activities. I would also say that, again, I'm gonna plug Ceres and Bicep because they've been an amazing partner as we navigate not only at the federal level, but also at the state level to support these policies that will allow for some really good climate policy that will create certainty. And then one thing that hasn't been said that I'd like to say is that along with certainty and will come innovation. So we feel that certainly having a tax on carbon will create a lot of innovation in the marketplace. And more than anything, we need to go fast and we need to change quickly.
Ellen, did you want to comment on that at all in terms of maybe working with your association or stepping out?
Sure. So we work with our Furniture Manufacturers Association, Business and Institutional Furniture Manufacturers Association, BIFMA. And they're also supportive of these concepts of certainly policy efficiency, but looking at the long-term impacts of potentially putting a price on carbon. And I just want to echo what Nick already said, that I would say policy efficiency is so critical for us, and that's what I've heard from our government affairs person, is that in order to operate efficiently, we need policy efficiency. And that's the way that we can bring more value to, you know, our stakeholders. So for us, again, it comes right back to certainty and predictability. You know, we know that we're getting into more extreme weather conditions. We know they might impact our supply chain, et cetera. How can we navigate that and make sure that we're as proactive as we can be?
Just real quick on the sort of talking to policymakers front. I think it was Alex in the earlier panel mentioned that he'd been with somebody like something like 70 members of Congress, and you know, only one denier, and everybody saying yes, this is an issue that needs to be dealt with, but the politics of it aren't great for them, and that is something that we need to be eyes wide open about. I mean, we are in a country that was founded in a tax revolt, right? I mean, taxes are four-letter words for a lot of people. So I think one of the things that I do, especially if I'm and my colleagues do, if we're talking with conservative members who are skeptical of taxes, or say, hey, I don't want to be primaried from the right if I come out in support of a carbon tax, I think it's important to remind people that one of the opportunities here, and this is certainly the case in the Climate Leadership Council's proposal, is that you have a suite of regulations that are out there. You could have a reform or modernization of policy broadly, where you put in an efficient, clear policy that's meaningful, and then you sweep away things that are inefficient or maybe high cost and low benefit. So there's an opportunity here. And there are a lot of members who just haven't even thought of it that way. They're just thinking, okay, you're coming in and you're just trying to jam a tax down my throat. Well, no, wait a minute. There's an opportunity here to do, broadly speaking, in the policy realm, something that is much, much better for the country and much, much more meaningful in terms of addressing this challenge.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. I think we have to wrap. I'm getting the signal over there. Thank you to the panelists.
Great. So, Eric and panel, thank you very much. We're going to take a short 10-minute break and then start again promptly at 3:15. There are some refreshments out the door to the left.
Just let them know that the bathrooms are to the right and to the right.
I'm going to let people ask.
Figure that out.
Outside ask. He's not. Yeah, I don't. I just wanted to say a word about the video.
I'm just going to say a
minute. So, folks, if you could grab a seat, thank you. We want to begin again. George, if you want one of those, those are available. And then all these, and then just turn your microphones on when you're ready.
Okay.
Great. So, if you could all grab a seat, we will begin again here in a moment. And Mitch Rofsky, are you here? If you come on up. Great, good. So folks, if you would grab a seat, I apologize for not providing more time for a break, but work. You know how that is.
Oops.
Careful.
Good.
There were a number of people that helped us a good deal in this and who aren't on the program, so we wanted to make a little time for them. And one of those people is Mitch Rofsky from Portland, Oregon, who's with the Better World Club. And Mitch has worked on carbon tax issues for many years. So we wanted to, as a sponsor of this event, give Mitch a minute or two to sort of lay out his vision and tell you a little bit about the Better World Club. Mitch, thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Richard. Richard originally asked me to speak for an hour and a half, but I said no, only a minute or two.
It's true.
Better World Club, we're the green alternative to AAA. AAA is part of the highway lobby, so we fight them on policy all over the place, all over the country, including on climate change. We're also a member of the American Sustainable Business Council and do quite a bit of our advocacy work on carbon taxes, et cetera, through ASBC. Better World Club, just like AAA, is auto insurance, emergency roadside assistance, travel, but of course we do a number of things, like we provide carbon offsets that cover all of our roadside assistance. We provide carbon offsets for our auto insurance customers. We discount our membership fees if you own a hybrid or an electric car. And we talk about climate change issues in our e-newsletter, Kicking Asphalt, which you can find online at betterworldclub.com. Very quickly, Richard wanted me to mention a few things that he and I have talked about over the years. The first is that as important as tipping points are, the environmental community, when we talk about climate change, we're emphasizing tipping points 20 and 30 years into the future too much. The American people don't vote on tipping points 20 and 30 years into the future. The American people vote on what's going on right now. And there is so much. The impact of climate change is being seen now, okay? All over, as we know, with the hurricanes, the forest fires, on and on and on. A number of years ago with the American Sustainable Business Council, we were at the White House, and we were listening to one of Obama's environmental advisors, and he started talking about how they just had to move a village in Alaska because it was flooding because of climate change. And I had to raise my hand and say, do I have to come to the White House to hear about this? To hear about what the impact of climate change is? This has to be out there. You need to be in the press and the environmental community. We have to be talking about today's impact a lot more than we are. The other thing I just wanted to mention, we support a carbon tax with dividends. And the reason for that is, as I think most of the people here in the room know, the marketplace is flawed in the sense that polluters don't have to clean up after themselves. Polluters can impose their costs on everybody, on third parties, on everybody. And it's not just that carbon should be cleaned up. In fact, all externalities should be taxed, and that money should go to clean up the pollution that's being created. But the tricky thing about the carbon tax is that because of, and now here I'll talk about a tipping point, because of tipping points in the future, then we probably need a carbon tax that's higher than just what it would cost to clean up whatever carbon we can clean up right at the moment. So if we're going to tax people more than the actual cleanup costs are, we need to get that money back to them. And I would just state that there's a model for this. And that model, if you're not familiar with it, is the Alaska Permanent Fund. So if everybody here could look up the Alaska Permanent Fund, which gives oil royalty money back to all Alaskans. Each Alaskan has gotten a check as high as over $2,000. So that's $8,000, over $8,000 for a family of four. It's a way we should have a national permanent fund, okay, that gives people money based on national resources, and the carbon tax could be the first step towards that. So with that, Richard, thank you very much, and thanks a lot.
Good, thank you. Good. Thank you, Mitch. Christina, we'll turn it over to you.
Okay, great, thank you so much, and I also wanna thank CCL and everybody else for organizing this event. To the videos?
Yeah. So we're...
You want me to discuss that and then...
Yeah, why don't you just give a little context,
terrific.
And then
okay.
Are we ready with the videos?
Okay,
great.
We are going to start this, which is great, with a video from Congressman Curbelo, who recently introduced a Republican carbon tax bill that had two other Republican co-sponsors on it, as well as Senator Schatz from Hawaii, who's has introduced a carbon tax dividend bill with Senator Whitehouse a while back, just to sort of set the flavor for talking about federal policy, the way forward, and some pieces here. They both would have liked to have been here, but couldn't be here, so we're delighted that they did videos for this specific event right now, so we'll go to those. Thanks.
Hello, I'm Congressman Carlos Curbelo, representative for South Florida in the U.S. House of Representatives and co-founder of the Bipartisan Climate Solutions Caucus. I'm sorry I couldn't join you in person today, but I want to thank you for your interest in innovative policy solutions to lower carbon emissions and protect our environment, and I want to thank you for your leadership. Despite this time of deep political division and some days even political chaos, earlier this year, I introduced a big, sober solution to address some of our country's greatest challenges. For years, Americans have been frustrated with our country's insufficient transportation infrastructure. Traffic congestion costs our economy billions of dollars each year, while diminishing quality of life for average Americans. Roads and bridges must be repaired and rebuilt, public transportation networks expanded, and airports modernized to secure a prosperous future for our country. The current administration has called for an ambitious infrastructure investment program, and Congress's response has been lukewarm at best. Another major concern for many Americans, especially among younger generations and those who live in coastal communities, is the reality of rising global temperatures, rising sea levels, and more extreme weather caused by the emission of greenhouse gases such as carbon dioxide. Already, my constituents in South Florida are experiencing the effects of higher sea levels with chronic coastal flooding and saltwater intrusion in the Everglades, which threatens our drinking water supply. Also, ocean acidification is damaging coral reefs and threatening the livelihoods of fishermen and charter boat captains and all who rely on our tourism industry. So all of this is why I filed the Market Choice Act, which recognizes the cost of carbon dioxide emissions while at the same time repealing the regressive discriminatory gas tax, which overburdens Americans who drive traditional vehicles and fails to fully fund our nation's infrastructure needs. First, the bill would set the United States on a plan to reduce carbon emissions and not only fulfill but exceed the commitments set out under the Paris Agreement. According to the study from Columbia University, the $24 per ton price this bill would set on carbon, with an annual 2% increase plus the consumer price index, would result in 27 to 32% reductions in carbon emissions by 2025 and 30 to 40% reductions by 2030. Second, the bill raises much-needed revenue to modernize our national infrastructure, a bipartisan priority that remains elusive without a new influx of revenue. Under the gasoline tax, the Highway Trust Fund is projected to receive $407 billion over the next 10 years. Our bill would provide an additional $285 billion, along with an additional $18 billion for the Airways Trust Fund. This robust investment in American infrastructure will result in reduced travel times, improved logistical efficiency, and economic growth. Third, the bill would eliminate regressive, inefficient, and discriminatory taxes like the gasoline tax and the aviation fuel tax to capture the entire economy. While the gas tax disproportionately affects those of lower and middle incomes who can't afford higher efficiency vehicles like Teslas, our bill promotes equitable treatment for Americans driving traditional cars and ensures all Americans are contributing their fair share to our country's infrastructure needs. The bill also creates long-term regulation stability by establishing a moratorium on the EPA from finalizing and enforcing Clean Air Act regulations on greenhouse gas emissions, thus providing much-needed regulatory certainty for utilities and businesses and limiting economic repercussions of additional regulations. Trade partners would be held accountable by way of a border tax adjustment, a concept advanced in the past by the Speaker of the House and Chairman of the Ways and Means Committee, and American exporters will be held harmless to protect their competitiveness. Additionally, there will be more certainty for workers and business as a result of a rolling moratorium on the EPA's regulation of greenhouse gas emissions. Lower-income Americans will be protected from higher utility bills, and assistance will be provided for displaced workers. In addition to all of this, modeling shows that under this policy, emissions reductions will exceed the goals outlined in the Paris Agreement. We've already seen enormous support for this kind of solution. Environmental and climate change advocates across the political spectrum have called it bold, innovative, and sensible. 34 diverse companies representing a wide cross-section of the U.S. economy welcomed this legislation for its contribution to the discussion. I truly believe that one day my Market Choice Act or legislation similar to it will become law. We simply owe it to every American, and especially to younger generations who are understandably concerned about the future. It's why in Congress I'm working with colleagues on both sides of the aisle to debate and support market-based solutions, investments, and innovations that could mitigate the effects of climate change and make our nation more resilient. And it's why your being here today is so important. Your passion and leadership can make a difference for a stronger economy and a healthier and cleaner planet. Thank you so much.
We have the video by Senator Schatz, right?
Hi, everyone. First, I want to thank Terry List Stoll and everyone at GAP for hosting this important event and for leading on climate. I'm hoping that since you're here today, you'll agree that a price on carbon is the best option that we have for bipartisan action on climate change. It's simple and it's straightforward. It's market-driven and business-friendly, and it doesn't expand regulations. In the Congress, I've introduced a carbon fee bill with Senator Sheldon Whitehouse that can appeal to both sides of the aisle. Our bill sets a meaningful price on carbon, one that's significant enough to change people's behaviors. Our bill will charge $50 per ton of CO2 equivalents, a price that would rise by 2% plus inflation every year. It protects American competitiveness through border adjustment taxes, and it lays the groundwork for communities to transition to a low-carbon economy in two essential ways. First, it provides up to $800 per person per year through a tax refund. And second, it provides grants that will help low-income and rural households lower their energy expenses and support job training and worker transition assistance. We're going to keep working on this bill until Congress catches up with the public and decides to take action. The good news is that there are signs that the dam is starting to break. We have strong bipartisan support outside of the Congress, from think tanks to big and small businesses. Even the big oil companies have formed a lobbying group and started to advocate for a carbon fee. We should approach some of these efforts with caution, but more importantly, we have to stay optimistic that this is a possible path forward and continue to push for action in Congress. And I know with your group's help, we're going to get there. Thanks very much.
Okay, terrific. We get to go a tiny bit over because we had to share time with those two guys, so which we were delighted to do. I want to just say a couple words of introduction. I'm Christina DeConcini, and I'm the Director of Government Affairs at the World Resources Institute. And for disclosure, we are enthusiastic about the introduction of the Curbelo bill. I was on Marketplace yesterday talking about that because it's been 10 years since we've had any Republican engagement in any meaningful way on climate, and we believe that a price on carbon is an essential piece of moving climate policy forward, and that it has to be bipartisan, as obviously everyone on this panel does too. But so that's, the reason why I'm saying that is this won't be an interesting discussion if I just throw a bunch of softball questions. So I'm going to intentionally ask my friends here challenging questions about, so that it's clear, I'm not a Pollyanna and I don't have rose-colored glasses on, just so that we can have a real discussion about what we're really facing here and trying to get this across the finish line at the federal level. Okay, so that's my disclosure, and this is sort of the crystal ball session. But I'm going to try to ask each of our panelists slightly different questions so we're not too repetitive, and I also want to leave a lot of time for questions from the audience. So I'm going to start with you, Mark, and we all applaud and recognize that CCL has done more than anybody in this space, but the difficult questions for you are, what if a lot of the Republican members of the Climate Solutions Caucus aren't reelected in November, diminishing the possibilities of bipartisan support? Do you think there's going to be other Republicans getting on the Curbelo bill, and why or when? And also, the what is your anticipation if the Democrats take control of the House? Do you, in terms of moving the bipartisan conversation forward?
Okay, well, let's start with the Climate Solutions Caucus. There's some members of the caucus on the Republican side that are retiring. There's some that will probably lose their race. So does that affect our ability to work across the aisle? And we don't think so. If you just look at time frame, for us to get Curbelo as the Republican lead, it took 3 years of us working in his district. We started the caucus with Representative Deutsch, and it was 3 years of bringing business leaders in, community leaders in. It was 3 years till we had one Republican. Coming out of the 2016 election, there were 6 Republicans left on the caucus. There's 43 now. So that we know our ability to build that caucus up quickly has accelerated significantly. So yeah, it could hurt, but it's not a damaging blow. And we think some people will be gone, but we'll be able to build that up. I think that it's really significant that 3 Republicans believe that it is politically smart for them to introduce a carbon tax this year. In Curbelo's own case, the Cook Report went him from a level to leaning R, and that's significant that Cook is now saying that that helped Curbelo to introduce a bill. I don't necessarily know if any more Republicans will jump on the bill, but it is really significant that Republicans feel that the political winds have shifted enough that they can introduce a carbon tax and be safe with it. What about the future? I don't know. I'm going to tell you a little bit about what the past tells us about that. So we have about 1,600 meetings with congressional offices every year, and we debrief those meetings, and we take them back to Congress to show how their views on dealing with climate change, specifically a fee on carbon with all the money going back to households, evolves over time. So 5 years ago, the most frequently frequently raised issue for us was China, which is essentially, if we do something and other countries don't, will that hurt us? That is now still an issue, but it's not at the top anymore. The last couple of years, it went from the China to the dividend, as in why this wouldn't work, to how would you make it work. The last 2 years, by far the most frequently raised issue was the Climate Solutions Caucus itself. So it seems that there's a lot of appetite and interest in Congress of how would working across the aisle work. Now, we don't have the full analysis for this year so far, but we do have two key committees of jurisdiction, Ways and Means in the House, Senate Finance. Overwhelmingly, those people were interested in first, the Climate Solutions Caucus, the second, the dividend, and third, really interesting this year, was pollution and health, which we believe is a winning issue in a bipartisan fashion because pollution and health isn't a Republican or a Democratic issue. I think that lends itself towards bipartisanship, and I don't know what will happen next year, but everything we're going to do is be to try and focus on something bipartisan.
Terrific. Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, I'm going to turn now to you, Josiah. You represent R Street, which is a center of right organization that's long supported a price on carbon. So I'm going to make you respond from all the Republicans. And my first question is, what is your thinking about how to explain the disconnect between the extreme position that this administration and president has taken on climate? Couldn't be more anti that, and at the same time having, for the first time in 10 years, even though it's only three, but three Republican members of Congress coming forward very publicly supporting this. And what does that, whatever your answer is on that, what does that tell you about what you're thinking about how we're going to break the gridlock and get a bipartisan solution? And if you have any other thoughts for the audience about what Trump voters are thinking about climate, that would be great too. Thanks.
Sure. Yeah, so I think it's no...
I told you.
Yeah, I was great to be here. It's not unique to me to say that we live in a very politically polarized time between the parties, left and right, Democrat, Republican. But I think it's also worth noting that not only are the parties polarized, but within the parties you have kind of internal polarization and fracture on each side. So sometimes, you know, when I go on Twitter and I look at my Democratic friends, it seems like the 2016 primary is still going on, and fans of Bernie and fans of Hillary are fighting each other. And you have a similar dynamic, I think, or analogous on the Republican side of the aisle, where, you know, there are different factions that, you know, does the Republican Party stand for free trade or does it stand for protectionism? There's all sorts of issues that they're being worked out. And one of the things that I think that has led to is kind of a rethinking and maybe a little bit more flexibility for people who, you know, when you're united, there's a lot of issues that, you know, I have some issues that are very important to me politically. And then there's some other issues that, you know, if that's what the party says, maybe you just go along with it and you don't really think about it that much. And when you have this kind of moment that it's not really clear what the party stands for, people can kind of have the freedom to rethink some of these things. And that, I think, is part of what we're seeing here with climate and some Republicans. And how that works out in the future is hard to say. Maybe we can talk more about that in the subsequent conversation, but I think that's what's happening, and I think that has created more freedom for folks like Representative Curbelo or others to kind of go back and think, well, you know, being a conservative doesn't mean that you have to say that the earth isn't getting warmer or anything like that. You can actually apply the same principles that you would apply to healthcare or you know, whatever. You can apply those in the climate context, too.
Mm-hmm. Great. And I just wanted to suggest that whoever's doing the cards, that maybe we can just start them since we want to have a lot of Q&A in this session.
Cards.
Pardon me? What?
Cards.
Right. Okay, so George, you and your organization have conducted dozens and dozens of Hill visits on pricing carbon, many with Republicans. And as Senator Schatz said,
We've known for a long time that there's a lot of Republicans not in Congress that support this. Great economists, former members, et cetera, which is great, and we've been involved with all of those conversations, but it really is very different and very validating when you have a Republican in Congress that's saying, I am a Republican and I want to see, you know, a carbon tax, et cetera. So I was, but at the same time, just to continue to try to pose a difficult question, just a few days before the Curbelo bill was introduced, we had the Scalise Amendment, and there were only 6 Republicans in the entire House of Congress that didn't vote for a resolution that said carbon taxes are terrible for the economy. So that would be a real mistake to just brush that over and pretend that that didn't happen. So I'm wondering how you square that, and how would, I mean, there's some people would say, and I'd love to hear yours or anybody else's comments on this, that the Curbelo bill was a political stunt. It's a one-off. By the way, I'm not saying this, so don't record that I'm saying. I'm asking the difficult question. But people are asking that, and is it really the beginning of something or just a one-time thing, and how does that fit in with Scalise, et cetera? So you can take it from there.
Well, I think it's a little bit of a straw in the wind. You know, it's when you, as was mentioned before, it's sometimes hard to remember that given the political polarization around climate change in the last 8 or 9 years, where if you're a member of the Republican tribe, you are really not supposed to be enthusiastic about the idea that climate change is a pressing problem, we need to do something aggressive about it, that, you know, in the run-up to the 2008 presidential campaign, that climate was a bipartisan issue, and cap and trade was a Republican idea, and half the senators who were sponsoring legislation were Republicans. So in light of the polarization that's occurred since then, I think it is a little bit ironic, but true, that what's emerged here in the last year or two is that the approach to climate change, carbon tax, carbon pricing, carbon fuel fee, that economists and policy wonks have known forever is the most efficient, certainly the least expensive, most transparent way to address the climate challenge, and which has been regarded for a long time as so politically radioactive, particularly with the Republican being a very anti-tax tribe, is emerging as probably the best and maybe the only way to begin to find some bipartisan support for congressional action. And if we're going to have a national climate policy, if we're going to decarbonize the world's largest economy built on carbon energy and carbon transportation, we're going to have some very aggressive price signals. But, of course, now, and I say perhaps the only, because there doesn't seem to be much real interest among Democrats or Republicans about a resurrecting cap and trade, looking back to the issues of Waxman-Markey and other systems. And if you, looking forward, if there's one thing that the Trump base, the traditional Republican Party, and a substantial amount of the business community agree on and will continue to agree on, they don't like regulation. So the idea that Congress is going to come to grips with climate change as public pressure grows in the next couple years through a massive new regulatory program, very unlikely. A carbon tax, on the other hand, a carbon fuel fee, has all these elements that theoretically should appeal to a bipartisan constituency. It's market-based, it can grow the economy, you know, a $30, $35 carbon tax going up a few percent over inflation gets us way past our Paris targets, generates $1.5 or $2 trillion in a very stressed out fiscal situation, can make a lot of regulation obsolete. So what's not to like about that from a bipartisan point of view? If you're looking now the next couple of years, as you mentioned, our little team has probably done at least 250 Hill visits in the last 2.5 years, more Republicans than Democrats, a lot of members, majority staff. And as Alex said, what you find, and people who are doing this know, that the significant majority of Republican members of the House and senators think climate change is real, would like to find something. I mean, they're concerned about their grandchildren, you know, would like to find something that their party could do about it. feel very painted into a corner by the political polarization. But, you know, if one person sticks his or her neck out, they'll get it's suicide. So it has to be, as Senator Whitehouse and others have said, a mass jailbreak. The politics have to change. And what people have said for 2.5 years is what we need is to have constituents, particularly from the business community, business leaders, my constituents, you have to tell me the carbon tax is a good idea. I know this is a good idea. I know this has got bipartisan support, but I have to have business people tell me that they have my back, that this is a good policy, a good fiscal policy as well as a good climate policy. So that, I think, is the key issue here to move this forward. And I would just say, without trying to be too critical, but you know, those of you who've worked in the sort of tech world have heard the expression the valley of death, which is between going from developing a new technology at the bench level to actually scaling it up. That's where 90% of companies fail, because they can't leap, they can't get the funding and to leap across the valley of death. In the case of climate policy, there's a similar valley of death in the business community. Increasingly, the companies who are sponsoring here and people you've heard, a lot of progressive action in the business community on climate within their own companies. So are we trying to be more efficient? We buy more green energy, we'll cut our emissions, we'll deal with our supply chain. Increasingly, large segment of the American business community has been doing that. But to take the leap, but it's a valley of death between that and going out and advocating for public policy. And that's something, unlike in Europe, unlike in Canada, where the business community have gotten very active on public policy, that hasn't happened in the business community in the US yet. And I would say Exelon is a fabulous example of what it takes to do that. But of course, in the year, the run-up to the 2016 election, we found in dealing with maybe 100 different businesses that you know, this was much too political and too partisan. People didn't want to stick their necks out. And since the 2016 election, it's not just on climate issues, but many other issues. You're a business leader, you're a CEO. The last thing you want to do in the world is stick your neck out on an issue that's not critical to your own business and put your eye, stick in the, you know, finger in the president's eye and get tweeted. So we now are sort of 3 years into a valley of death situation with climate policy. That's going to change because probably within 2 months, the next generation of climate policy legislative proposals are going to be on the table. People are going to be putting them together. They're going to be introducing them in a, probably if either house goes Democratic, there's going to be a huge new debate, brand new debate about the future of climate legislation starting in a matter of months. And then the issue for the business community is, in spite of all the progressive things that you've done as a company, in your industry, internally, are you prepared to get out there, jump across the valley of death, and take a public position favoring some sort of aggressive congressional legislation to meet the climate challenge? And that test is coming soon.
I want to say one thing about the Scalise Amendment, which is a non-binding resolution. This is the third time it's been brought up in Congress. The previous two Congress, every single Republican voted for it. This time,
including Curbelo.
Including Curbelo. This time, six Republicans voted against it. One voted present. Two chose not to show up and vote. And we know there was a lot of resentment on the Hill that they were being whipped so hard by Scalise to vote for it and that they didn't really give them time to discuss it. So, you know, I think you don't last long in politics if you're instincts on shifting political winds aren't good. And I think that's some indication that they're sensing there's something different changing out there, that they can vote in a way that's way different than any Republican that voted.
Okay, thank you. All right, so I wanted to just second or third or fourth George saying that one thing we do here on the Hill a lot, even though policy isn't moving, that members in the middle really need to hear from CEOs of large corporations directly and publicly that they would like
legislation to move forward. But I'm going to go to the questions now. I'm trying to sort of group a bunch of them. So I'm going to start with you, Josiah, because you're speaking for all Republicans everywhere.
I should note our street is a nonpartisan organization.
I know.
So I am a Republican, but I'll speak for conservatives. But
okay, yeah, that's a joke from me. But but here are the questions: Are anti-climate people in Congress more afraid of their constituents or the Tea Party and Koch brothers? What messages would Republican legislatures need to hear and from whom to get on board with a carbon tax? Who would be the most effective messengers? And then there's a couple sort of funny ones here. How could we, is there a way to make this into an idea? So even if there was a blue wave and something moved forward, how could we get the president to pretend that it was his idea and persuade him that it was his idea? Okay.
All right. Well, very interesting. All right. So you got there's a couple of questions there. I think that in terms of how to get more congressional interest, the biggest problem, as I see it, and this is true certainly for Republicans, but it's also true for a lot of Democrats, is that if you look at the polling on climate issues, the numbers look pretty good, right? Most Americans recognize that climate change is happening. They think that humans are responsible. They're pretty favorable if you poll them on different legislative things, whatever it is, right? But the issue is, it's not a priority issue, right? It's ranks, if you give them 15 options, which are the most important issues, it's like 13, 14, right? So they think about jobs, the economy, some social issues like immigration. That's what gets people's, riled up, right? Because of that, most representatives don't feel like it's worth sticking their neck out or devoting a lot of time to it, unless they're either in a very special circumstance or they have a passion about it. I think Representative Curbelo is clear even before he got into politics. He cares deeply about this particular issue, and I think that's probably true of some of the, Senator Whitehouse, for example, right? He doesn't need that issue, right, for an electorally thing. He just really cares about that issue. So that I think is a big, it's not a hostility so much as an apathy thing that is just hard to overcome. In terms of what are some framing or how do you appeal to conservatives on this? I think we've heard in prior panels, and then George, you mentioned it, some of the things that we've talked about and other people have talked about. One is, how do you use the revenue? Can you use the revenue in ways that people might find appealing, even if they don't care about the climate stuff very much? Efficiency, you mentioned the carbon tax is efficient. One thing that I would say that I don't think has gotten enough stress is that of the different ways to try and address climate change, a carbon tax is the one that best respects individual human freedom and liberty. And what I mean by that is that if you have a carbon tax, you are not telling people you have to use this kind of light bulb, right? You're not telling people you have to drive this kind of car, right? People, each individual gets to decide for themselves how are they going to respond to the price bearing the cost, and how are they going to best reduce their emissions or continue to, find alternatives. They have to pay for it, right? So there's a reality that some things are going to be more expensive. People are not going to want to do it. But it respects the individual choice that each person gets to choose for themselves, as opposed to feeling like someone else is telling me how to live my life, right? So I think that's a key issue there that I don't think we stress enough.
Great, thank you.
Can I respond to that? I think those are good arguments to Republicans whose principal objections are, one, it's taking away my freedom, and two, it's a Democratic plot to grow government expenditure. And then when you say, well, we could give it all back to individual families or in tax, we could be revenue neutral, and the Republican answer is Congress never going to allow that once you get the money and they're always going to grab it for more government. But I think that if you look at this from a more sort of bipartisan driving the debate point of view, as Alex Flint said, the fact that a carbon tax could be a very good fiscal policy, climate irrelevant, is you know, as we begin to look at a deficit that's debt that's going way out of whack from World War II, the availability of the money to do infrastructure and to do some debt relief and make individual tax cuts permanent, the availability of this funding, and there isn't anything else that produces this kind of money, could be the most powerful thing in the short term that moves this with Republicans as well as Democrats.
Okay, we only have a couple more minutes. I was going to ask Mark a question and George, but George, you used your time. So because we only have, Richard's telling me just a couple more minutes. So, but thank you very much for that. And I guess just a thing that we're not going to talk about right now, but the one thing I have to respond to that is this idea that Republicans in Congress are going to respond to this fiscal crisis, I think, is dubious when you see the evidence from the tax bill that was just passed. I'm just saying that to make the argument that they're going to suddenly really, really care about that, that was an argument going up before. But anyway, Mark, here's a question for you. How will CCL address Republican defensiveness if Democrats were to take the House and introduce a climate bill or a carbon tax bill? And then with that, we're unfortunately going to have to wrap up just because they want to keep things going here. But
okay.
You have the last
if
word.
I can just go back to the last question for just a second is, you know, I just want to say for the BCL, business climate leaders who organize this, Congress needs to hear from businesses. The people on the previous panel were so important. The more we can encourage that to happen, messenger is more important than message. We all need to be encouraging that. Now, the question is, if Democrats take it, we know enough about social psychology now to know that if Democrats introduce it, Republicans are against it because Democrats introduced it. And if Republicans introduce it, Democrats are against it because same thing, right? So we all need to work really hard to make sure that anything comes out is a bipartisan bill. It would be a mistake for us to let, if the Democrats take the House, the Democrats to introduce a bill that's a Democrat-only bill. That would do more damage to the will that we've created getting the Climate Solutions Caucus working together than a lot of other things. So I think that for people who are on the left, you've got to work really hard if your member gets elected to say, we need a bipartisan solution, not a Democratic solution.
Okay, terrific. Well, we're going to wrap it up. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Very much.
Thank you.
Josiah. Good. Thank you all. That was a great panel. Great political insight. Christine, I'll take those questions. Good, good, no problem, thank you. Good, good. So one of the other sponsors we've had is...
Hello, I'm...
From EarthX. And EarthX is an organization based in Dallas, Texas that organizes an annual huge Earth Environmental Expo trade show, exhibits, and Trammell Crow is with us. Trammell is a good friend to environmental causes, and Trammell has created really one of the world's greatest environmental expos.
The biggest
in the country, 130,000, 140,000 people come. So we wanted to give Trammell a few moments to tell us about what goes on in Dallas each year and why he is committed to addressing climate change.
Thank you, Richard. Thank you, everybody. I say biggest because it's in Texas, and that's the reason why you should all come, because we need you there to continue the dialogue. It's been 8 years now that we've had this event, like maybe not in this room, but like many environmental activists today. They went many decades of their life without being that, as did I. I finally got out of my environmental easy chair about 10 years ago when two businessmen came to me in Dallas, founder of Hotel.com and founder of Container Store, and asked me to join them when TXU, our local utility, was applying for 11 permits for coal-fired plants on a fast-track basis with Rick Perry. And that immediately sent up some red flags to me because it was pretty common knowledge that 12 plants were not needed at that time. We created Texas Business for Clean Air, the first time there'd ever been an organization with business and clean together in the state of Texas. After a year or two, that battle was won. We played a small part. We created a different spin. We recruited 250 business leaders in Dallas, Fort Worth, Houston, San Antonio, Austin, Texas, Houston and San Antonio, El Paso, who didn't necessarily contribute money, but put their names on our roster. And with that, we went anywhere in the Texas capital that we wanted to go and really changed the minds of many of our very conservative members. That's what converted me, not into an environmentalist, but to an activist, realizing it was time that things could be achieved in Texas. Not doing my research, I just decided the next thing we'd do is have a good old Earth Day, thinking that meant an expo of environmental groups all showing what they do so Texans who had a very little and have today a very little awareness level of what the problems are and what the solutions can be could learn with a very steep learning curve. That's what happened. We had 200 exhibitors, I call them, and 40,000 people in 2011. Today, we have 140,000 visitors and 750 exhibitors, 30 full-length documentary films, 35 virtual reality pieces on environment, 400 speakers, and on and on. But 12 is our little number. We have 12 conferences on ocean, legal, corporate sustainability, university.
Clean energy.
Bipartisanism, clean air, city resiliency, and so forth. And again, not knowing better, we've put these all together. So when you all from the West Coast and the East Coast come here in Dallas, you see a mighty exposition that doesn't exist anywhere else. And it has created an optimism in the vocabulary of Mr. Bill Sharman with Future 500 here in San Francisco that speaks to Texans. Come next April, 24 to 28, takes that long to fit it all in, and not just continue another dialogue, but help our business community and our general public and our various audiences hear dialogues that they've never heard before. We need you there. So y'all come here.
Good. Thanks, Trammell. Good. Thank you, Trammell. And thank EarthX for being one of our sponsors. So let's have the next panel come up. And this next panel is on what's happening at the state level. So have a seat, wherever you'd like to sit. And Senator Barrett and Mark, if you join us, great. Do you have a microphone there? Okay.
He's here somewhere.
Yep, okay. So, Harold, are you sitting in for? Yeah. Harold has just been promoted to a state senator. Excellent. All right, Senator Barrett, thank you, sir. That's good. Political aspirations right here. He's running on a 100% climate neutral policy. We've heard a lot about what's happening at the federal level. Well, as many of you know, the same challenge, the same struggle same effort is being made across the country. And could I have that clicker? Thank you. So we have, I think, about a dozen states that have active efforts underway to initiate a price on carbon, particularly a tax. And what's really interesting is those vary dramatically from one state to another. What we have now learned, not surprisingly, is there's no one size fits all. And yet there are some common ingredients between what's happening in those states, from Washington to Massachusetts to Oregon to Pennsylvania to Maryland, right? There are lots of efforts happening, right? And they're being driven by a number of the same forces and coalitions that we see evolving at the federal level. So this panel is an opportunity to talk about that. And we have Mark Breslow, an economist who works with the Climate Action Business Alliance and Climate Exchange in Massachusetts. That's where Mark's located. One of our sponsors, Michelle Romero from Green for All. Mo McBroom from the Yes on 1631 in Washington State, which is on the ballot on November 6th. Camilla Thorndike from Washington, D.C. area, who's worked on a recent initiative in D.C. that didn't work out, but we all learned a lot. And then Senator Mike Barrett from Massachusetts, who's been a climate pioneer now for, I think, 5 or 6 years. What we want to do in this panel is look at some of the strategies that are being used at the states, how you all can participate and in those efforts in your own state. You know, part of the strategy and part of the thinking is if we move legislation at the state level, that may motivate federal legislation, because we're not really sure what's going to happen in Congress, right? We understand the complexities of getting, of pushing something to the state level. It may prompt a pushback at the federal level. It may cause greater incentive to act, or it may not. So, Mo, let me start with you. In Washington State, this is, I think, your third go-round, right?
Second
on the ballot, right. And you've chosen, rather than through a legislative effort, which I know there have been a previous effort, to now go to the voters in November. And I also wanted to just acknowledge you, Senator Ranker here from Washington State. Good. So the senator has been a major champion in the legislature, which is really... Well...
You got us here.
We thank you for your effort. So, Mo, what is the strategy to get voters to come out and approve this initiative this time around?
Okay, thanks. You stole my thunder a little bit. I was going to acknowledge that there's been a long path in Washington State and a lot of leadership from our elected officials, Senator Ranker being a central one, also our governor. But despite that amazing leadership, we've had some significant challenges. We have not been able to get a carbon pricing policy over the line, despite many, many years of action. I should have started by saying that when I'm not directly working on 1631, and actually even when I am, I'm with the Nature Conservancy. That is my affiliation. And the Nature Conservancy is a global organization which is pushing for action on climate. And we are agnostic with regard to what type of climate policy. There are as many different climate policies, as other speakers have mentioned, that could work. And our challenge is getting something done. We believe action at the state level is a critical part of the path to the national and ultimately global solutions we're going to need to see. So we are focused on Washington. We are hoping to win in November. And we see this as a pivotal moment in the broader long-term conversation about national action on climate. So as we have taken this journey, despite huge efforts in our state legislature, we've not quite gotten there. And in 2016, there was a revenue neutral carbon tax proposal which was on the ballot and which failed. And a lot of folks were worried that that was going to set us back. I am proud to say that, you know, because of the dedication of many, our state has rallied now behind a new proposal which has a real shot in November. It's fundamentally different in a few ways, and I'll talk about that, with regard to its viability. A previous speaker said that we need policy that is effective, durable, and fair. I would agree with all of those things. I would add viable to that mix as well, especially when you're talking about a vote of the people. And for us, viability has to do with where we started and how we're moving forward on this journey. Rather than a bunch of environmentalists and economists kind of coming up with the perfect policy, we recognize that especially when you're talking about state action, we need to craft a policy that is specific to the particular communities, the business community, rural communities, urban communities, in the place where that policy is going to land. So for the last 2.5 years in Washington State, we have hosted a very robust dialogue that has brought in voices that you don't often hear in the climate movement. Obviously, the economic impacts and the business impacts are front and very important here, and we've talked to a wide swath of the business community as we have developed a policy. But even more important from my perspective is working with those communities who ultimately are most impacted by climate change. So that means talking with tribal communities, talking with communities of color, recent immigrants, rural folks who are struggling financially, farm workers, the list goes on and on, but we need to bring those voices in, not just as folks who we bring into the coalition after the policy is baked, but at the very beginning, so that we know we're crafting a policy that works across the economic spectrum, across the political spectrum, and lands well in the communities that most need the help. Good. So after that dialogue, where we ended up in Washington is we have a package of investments that will ultimately cause major carbon emission reductions in our state. So this is an investment strategy. It is, we call it a fee rather than a tax, because we're not putting a price on carbon simply to make carbon more expensive so people will turn away from it. We're thinking about how do we transition our economy fundamentally and invest in things and provide incentives to both families and to businesses to move away from more polluting technologies. In Washington, our policy package, 70% goes directly to carbon reduction, so that's like clean energy, that is energy efficiency, it's vehicle electrification. 30% goes to addressing the impacts of climate change that, as we were just discussing in an earlier panel, are already here. So how do we invest in forest fire risk reduction, water supply, flooding, and community safety? So this package does all that. It does it with a fee on carbon emissions levied on the largest emitters in our state. The fee starts at $15 a ton. It goes up $2 a year until we meet our state's carbon emission reduction goals, so it is performance-based. And then finally, there is also a regulatory a relief component. We would repeal an existing clean air rule at the state level. So it's not different in many ways from many of the policies that have been discussed earlier in the day. It is fundamentally different, I think, in the way the policy came about and what that means for who is supporting it. And hopefully that will help us get it across the finish line in November.
Yeah, just hang on to that just one sec. So, you know, I think two takeaways. You know, one, who's involved in crafting the policy sounds like it's really important. And then the investment strategies in Washington. So, Michelle, if you would wait one moment. I wanted to ask Senator Barrett, so in Massachusetts, different scenario, right? So you've been at this for 5-6 legislative sessions now, have tried a number of different strategies, different than Washington State. And I remember one of the things that you said when we were talking recently was that because Massachusetts doesn't have a lot of old line polluting traditionally carbon intensive industries, it's more of a challenge to, and
well, it's certainly a, yeah. Certainly a different conversation. But first of all, I want to tip my hat to Washington State. You guys are doing a terrific job. And I want to,
You want it on too.
Very demanding.
I was tipping my hat to Washington State for doing terrific work, and I want to temper the mood, or I should say I want to fool with the mood by being optimistic. Politically incorrect, maybe sometimes when we discuss this issue. 4 months ago, the Massachusetts State Senate, which includes seven Republicans, voted unanimously on behalf of a carbon pricing scheme that gave the governor very tight deadlines, 24 months, to impose either cap and trade or a revenue positive tax or a revenue neutral fee. For us in Massachusetts, I have been working at this for 5 years, what really, we had a narrow majority, I think, anyway, but what really produced a unanimous vote and a bipartisan one is that we lifted the burden of choice from the legislators, not exactly a profile and courage observation, but there you have it, and gave them the option of being tough on deadlines, but flexible with regard to tools. That turned out to be magical for us. So that does make me very optimistic. But here's the other thing that's changed in Massachusetts. The House, by the way, did not go along this time. Faced with this novel idea, they balked. The other thing I'm seeing, though, is a politicization of climate change in a way that hasn't been the case in the past. For 5 years, this has been the province of policy wonks and nerds. And you could speak to select audiences, but it was very hard to galvanize your typical voter who's got her mind or his mind on a lot of things. That has changed. In Massachusetts, and I can only speak to my own state, people are terrified about climate change. And what you've seen in Massachusetts is a kind of a dual radicalization. Voters on the Democratic side, especially women, have been radicalized by the presidency of Donald Trump. They are angry, they are agitated, they are working harder than ever before and overthrowing incumbents. It happened in our primary 1 month ago, who for some reason, I think rightly, are on the wrong side of that fence. The second instance of radicalization, though, does have to do with climate change. We don't have any deniers in Massachusetts, and folks who temporize on possible solutions are finding themselves on the wrong side of history and the wrong side of a near-term political dynamic. So we saw people go down specifically because climate change activists went door-to-door in their districts. I'm not supposing that the matter of dealing with a more conservative but heavily Democratic Massachusetts House is going to be an easy one, but I predict that because of Trump and because of climate, including these storms, you are going to see many incumbents, especially in our more moderate House of Representatives, threatened with primary races, which is where the real action is in blue state Massachusetts, specifically around climate and even more particularly around carbon pricing. So it is true, though, on the other hand, that every state's story is unique. Half the states in the United States have no extractive industries at all. We don't do coal. We have no oil, we have no natural gas. So for us, the idea of moving safely upstream, away from the attention span of the voter, in the hopes that she won't notice that we've raised the price of her fossil fuel, is less of a possibility. We've got to deal with people more or less directly and honestly. And I might say, as somebody who's interested in this issue precisely because I want the individual consumer to get, well, a market signal, I'm disquieted by the fact that the sales of SUVs and light trucks are way up given the cheapness of gas and the sales of fuel efficiency vehicles are way down. So it's not enough for me personally as a policymaker to see some middle person, some middleman absorb the price signal. I do want it to resonate with my voters. I want us to take those risks because that behavior, the consumer piece, has got to change if we're going to drive down emissions beyond electric power and actually be effective in the transportation sector. We've got to be willing to suppose that the individual behavior that changes is not, as I say, a corporate middle structure, but the consumer herself. I'm optimistic that we're going to get there because my constituents are increasingly terrified about the alternatives.
Good. Let me ask you, thank you for that description. And let me ask Camila to sort of piggyback on that, because in some sense, Washington, D.C.'s economy is, you know, is certainly not a heavily industrialized economy. You have proposed a $10 per ton tax, went through you. So maybe give us a few details on that, but I'd also like you to describe for the benefit of the audience sort of the process of finding a champion, of recruiting allies, and you know, what did not work and what you will do differently next time.
Great, yes. So these are moderately fresh wounds that I am sort of making sense of, but I've had the pleasure of working with the Chesapeake Climate Action Network, or CCAN, in DC for the last couple years, and before that helped start Our Climate, there you guys are, which is mobilizing young people across the country for carbon pricing. So I've worked in Oregon, sort of tangentially followed the Washington struggle, and now in DC and a number of other states, and I've seen a few key ingredients that various campaigns have nailed or not nailed, and now I think I've got my head wrapped around the ingredients that you have to have in place. And the first one you mentioned is a champion. If you're going to go a legislative route, unfortunately, we thought we were developing a champion in the DC Council, which really should be a state legislature, but Republicans in Congress will never allow us to be, or at least until things change. So yes, we need a 51st permanently pro-climate state. So the champion element is incredibly important, because in our case, there's only 13 lawmakers, and with a jurisdiction that voted 96% Democrat in the last election, it's really the primaries where you've got the only chance for accountability. And in our case, the lawmaker we were working with has been a real champion on environmental issues, but never felt that carbon pricing passion. And I can't imagine how you wouldn't feel that in the marrow of your bones. But that was the case. And unfortunately, she made public commitments that, yes, this is a great policy. Yes, I'm going to get it done. And it's because we'd built so much political pressure. But then she chose at the very last minute, after rolling out carbon pricing kind of floaters that would have enacted $100 per ton carbon tax on transportation and natural gas, and paired with a 100% renewable portfolio standard on electricity, and at the very last minute sort of ditched that carbon tax element and introduced just the RPS with a number of other really bold measures, including a building energy performance standard and increasing a fee that is on dirty energy in the district would equivalent, $3 carbon tax would be the equivalent, so not a huge step forward. But you really, I think, have to have somebody who has that that commitment to the issue. But then you have to have the other ingredients, which I think we've seen states developing in terms of a coalition and the grassroots kind of groundswell. So in our case, we have 100 organizations really across all sectors in DC who rallied in a very cohesive way for this carbon fee rebate and investment strategy that we had developed with the help of a professional facilitator who really helped us bring stakeholders to the table, make sure that all voices were being heard, and that anybody who felt you know, rebuffed in previous environmental campaigns or not brought to the table had every avenue for full participation. And at the end of that process, which I highly recommend having a professional facilitator help you in that, we had 100% consensus behind our policy approach, which was a $10 per ton per carbon tax going up $10 every year to a cap of 150 in the end. And the majority funds going back in per capita rebates with a portion for investments in equitable green investments, and then a small tax credit for businesses. So that was our policy, and we had the coalition, we had SEIU, Working Families Party, equity-oriented neighborhood organizations, all of the major environmental groups working in the area. We had dozens of small businesses, and really just this incredible excitement that was also aided by the third ingredient. I would say you do have to have the base. So to the senator's point, just to have constituents who are elevating this issue as a top priority, DC happens to have one of the most concentrated dots on the map in terms of climate alarm. And so we had this really sophisticated group of people who maybe are working on climate in their day jobs and then would turn out for rallies and lobby days. So the fifth, we've got coalition, base, champion, actually six. I think you need these anchor organizations. So the large organizations like TNC or Green for All or others who are willing to see this idea through to the end alongside grassroots activists. And then the funders who are going to make that possible, because I think there's this expectation for a quick turnaround. And these are minimum 3 year, probably more like 6 to 10 year long efforts just to get the basic education out there. So there's a lot more I could say, but
yeah, well, good.
That's my little book.
Yeah, thank you for that. let's circle back to that. Michelle, I wanted to bring you into this conversation. And Green for All has been thinking about these issues for a long time, about a just transition and about how communities that have been disproportionately impacted by intensive carbon-intensive industries and hazardous waste sites have borne the brunt of the economic success. So when you think about just transition and you think about these three examples, what are some of the sort of non-negotiable points that Green for All and other environmental justice activists want to see embedded in any policy solution?
Thanks for asking. So, you know, like you mentioned, you know, Green for All is about how are we going to build a green economy for everyone. Green needs to be for all, not just for some. And so, you know, one of the non-negotiables is nothing about us without us. And low-income communities and communities of color are hit first and worst by the pollution-based economy. You've got 68% of African Americans that live within 30 miles of a coal-fired power plant. You have 80% of Latinos in the U.S. living in areas that do not even meet the Environmental Protection Agency's standards for air quality. These are big numbers. That's most of these communities. And so, you know, when we talk about, and earlier you said, carbon pricing policy that's effective, durable, and fair, you can't do that without us at the table. And so, making sure that the policies address the needs of these communities and that we aren't just reducing carbon emissions on a global scale, but that we are reducing carbon emissions on a local scale too, and not just, you know, ending up with a more of an eco divide than we already have. And so a couple of other things, you know, as you mentioned, Mo, getting that coalition together was key. I think it's key not just because it's the right thing to do, and I want to emphasize that. We're here to talk about the business case for a carbon tax, right? So it's not only the moral thing to do. It is the moral thing to do. But it isn't only the moral thing to do, right? Because of this process that the Alliance for Jobs and Clean Energy front and center and so many groups in Washington worked through to design a policy that would do the least harm and the most good to these communities, we ended up with a fundamentally different policy. It still prices polluters for the cost of their pollution, right? Just holding people accountable. It's quite fair. It's not punitive. No one's trying to, like, you know, go and knock someone over the head for anything that isn't fair. It's just we're all paying the price of pollution today, and right now the burden of that cost is being put on struggling families' shoulders. And so it's just about making sure that polluters are accountable for their share of the damage that they're causing and shifting those funds into the communities that they've harmed. But it's good for durability, because right here in California, back in the day when we passed AB 32 and you know, the state of California chose to pursue a carbon cap and trade system, you know, you had oil and gas putting a ballot initiative on the ballot to basically tell low-income communities it's going to raise your gas prices, it's going to do all these bad things to your community, and you don't really benefit from it. And you know what? It was kind of true. And so while in the environmental community, we sometimes look at these underserved communities as stakeholders that aren't really
all that important to have at the front end because perhaps politically they don't seem powerful. Our opponents absolutely look at our communities as the very first place to go because you haven't talked to us, right? And so it's durable because it sort of ensures that, you know, the next year you aren't fighting the same battle over and over, and we can actually move forward to the next thing. But for business, I want to emphasize that, you know, the other thing that we think is non-negotiable is that we have to, as someone said earlier, I think it was the panel before us, they were saying there are so many climate policies, right? And a carbon tax is not going to solve the climate crisis alone. But it is perhaps the only solution that is on the table that has the potential to raise billions of dollars, if not trillions of dollars, if we all did it. And what we do with that revenue could literally be the difference between life and death, could literally be the difference between a thriving, clean economy that benefits everybody or a situation where we're all wiped off the map. And so dedicating a portion of these investments into clean energy, weatherizing homes, getting electric ride shares for rural communities to improve job opportunities, mobility access to healthcare in these communities, putting people to work and, you know, building the solar panels, working on the biofuels, all these kind of technologies can actually fight poverty and pollution at the same time and accelerate our transition. It'll grow green business. It'll help us get from just the early adopters who can afford the price of a Tesla or the price of solar panels to everybody being able to access the clean energy economy. And so that's good for everyone.
Great, great. Yeah, no, that is a helpful. That is a helpful analysis. Mark, let me turn to you as sort of, you know, as a resident economist who thinks about trade-offs.
Dirty word.
No, not at all. No, that's a compliment. About these trade-offs, and I think we've seen in each of these examples, state by state, and also with Michelle's sort of broader perspective, that you can't do everything. You have to make choices, and that the design of any given policy, you know, has certain economic impacts. So I know you've thought about how you design a policy and what its objectives are and what constituencies and outcomes are you trying to serve. So in your work nationally, what insights have you developed about that? Yeah, just push that up. Is it? Sure, I think there's another one there. Is that working?
Yes, okay.
So I think what we found is that in each state a different choice is being made. So if we look at those of us up here, Senator Barrett's bill is 100% revenue neutral. The Washington, D.C. bill is what percentage? It's like 80 or 90% returned, is that right? Okay. The Washington State bill is 100% investment and just transition, right? We also have a second bill in Massachusetts that's 80% rebate and 20% investment. The New York State bill is 70% investment, 30% rebate, approximately. So the political conditions and judgments are being made differently in each state, and I'm not sure there's any simple right answer. I think the one answer is that, in my opinion, that low and moderate income people need to be protected one way or another. And I feel at least that it should not only be low, it should also be moderate as a political judgment. And some other people in New York State, they're kind of, I think, making that not quite including moderate very much. You can do that in two different ways. One way is the fully dividend or rebate method where you give enough money back that the rebate or dividend more than covers what you pay in. Another way to do it is to invest the money in things that help low and moderate income people do energy efficiency, do renewable energy, help them buy a more efficient car or an electric car. Those are two different ways of getting to the same thing, and there's differences of opinion as to how much money should go to that or whether you should do one or the other. In Massachusetts, we have tried to be agnostic on that because we have two bills, Senator Barrett's and a different one in the House, and we're supporting both, and they make slightly different judgments. And I think at least for our coalition, our decision is we'll support whichever one we can get in the end. But the equity component is essential, and a process in which, as Michelle said, the right organizations are included and have a voice in helping figure that out is important. I think Washington State and DC both had very extensive processes. I don't think we had quite as much of one in Massachusetts. I think you need to look at the numbers and you need to look at a careful design of exactly how you do the dividends or how you do the investment, because either one you could do it in a way that wouldn't work out the way you want it to. And as an economist, I ran all these numbers in Massachusetts and tried a dozen different scenarios. I'll hand it back to you in a second. And tried to work out the numbers so that we could have the vast majority of lower income households come out ahead. It took some work in creating formulas to do that.
Hold on to that. I have this. But let me ask you, when I think back to some of the conversations last year around the idea of a federal carbon tax, there was the possibility of a trade-off. We impose a carbon tax and reduce the corporate income tax, or there might be some grand bargain in what became, the tax bill this year. But that didn't happen, obviously. But when you think about the trade-offs, is it possible that you could reduce one other tax for the carbon tax? And we saw that in Congressman Curbelo's proposal, right? So he was essentially saying, let's do away with the gas tax and have a carbon tax, right? So is there a parallel there at the state level?
Let me avoid the Congressman Curbelo question,
okay.
If you'll permit me.
Sure.
But I think that the basic conclusion is that if you're going to cut a tax, it needs to be a tax that's at least as regressive as the carbon tax would be. All right? That's getting a little bit technical. But we know that a carbon fee or tax will take a larger percentage of money away from low-income people than higher income. If you cut a tax, say the income tax, the state income tax in most states, that's very little of that in most places is paid by lower income or even moderate income people. It's mostly paid by higher income. So lower income people are going to lose if you do that trade-off. What exactly the numbers are is different for every state. So in Massachusetts, because say the sales tax also turns out not to be a good trade-off, because lower-income people don't pay that much of the sales tax because we exempt food, clothing, and other things. In Washington State, because you don't have an income tax, right, the sales tax is carrying more of the burden, as are property taxes, and the numbers might work out better there, but I wouldn't know without actually examining them. So you have to look at the numbers in each state, and you've got to make sure that if you're raising carbon fees and lowering something else, that the right people are benefiting. And if that's not true, which has not been the case in the several states that I've worked on, then a rebate or a dividend that's flat or that even gives more money back to lower income than higher income is a better choice.
Mm-hmm. And Senator Barrett, when you hear that and you think about the objectives of your legislative efforts in Massachusetts, what are you trying to accomplish? You're trying to stimulate the economy, you're trying to reinvest money in green infrastructure?
Well, I should mention that Mark and I have been working closely
right on
all these things for the entire 5 years, so we've kind of crunched the numbers and made policy decisions together in many cases. And one important thing to emphasize again is that everything is situationally specific. It's extraordinary as you get close to a given state how different it is even from its neighbors. So it is the case, for example, in Massachusetts, that the least regressive thing to do is strict revenue neutrality. If we send back, if we collect money, energy consumption in Massachusetts scales up with income. You want to talk about another kind of unfairness. It's that people with more money get to spend more fossil fuel. They have the third car in the driveway. They have the summer place down on the Cape. So if we collect money, we're collecting it from people with a little more money on balance. If we then redistribute it per capita, flat rate, the lowest 60% of Massachusetts households in terms of income will get back more in rebate than they will have paid originally in the fee. So strict revenue neutrality turns out in that sense to hold not only poor families, but working class and middle income families, it holds them harmless, and that's critically important. That said, I think Massachusetts, and here's where the choices become very difficult for us, I'm just predicting that in the next 2 years we're going to raise taxes in Massachusetts. We had hopes for a progressive income tax that our state Supreme Court dashed at the very last minute. I thought we were going to have a policy twofer in which we could distribute back all of a carbon fee, because that actually is the most progressive thing to do in terms of protecting poor people, but could raise money progressively using a progressive income tax. That twofer is now no longer a possibility. I think the legislature, and it does do this in Massachusetts every half dozen years, is going to have to raise taxes to fund our schools, which are also very regressively financed at the moment. When we have that tax debate, which would be a revenue positive debate by definition, we would give the state government money to spend, I want the carbon tax to be the preeminent choice. So since we're going to raise taxes anyway and get over that hump, which granted is a tough one for politicians, but we do get it over in blue Massachusetts, we get over that hump collectively. Since we're going to do it, the critical question is, can we position carbon pricing as the way to do it? I think the chances are very good that we can do that.
Mm-hmm. Let me ask, are there questions from the audience? If there are, I'm happy to take those cards. But in the meantime, Michelle, did you want to comment on that as far as how that would affect low-income communities?
You feel me on the edge of my seat?
I did. I felt that.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I think the idea of just a dividend back to households, right, to say, well, if we do a carbon tax, then it might increase the price of gas on some households. It might increase, you know, the cost for some low-income consumers. And so let's just give them a check back to kind of offset that amount. That's to offset the amount of the new harm based on the carbon tax. It does nothing for the harm that is already happening. And so, you know, I think for a long time when we talk about equality or we talk about equity and the civil rights community, it's our fault. Like, the civil rights community has done such a good job at the do no harm message and playing defense, right? Please don't do any more bad stuff to us, that we haven't yet really shifted to actually we need to really do a lot of positive, proactive, good stuff. We need to do a lot of positive, proactive investing in these communities to bring them just up to where everyone else is. And so I love that you're thinking about, you know, how do you use these revenues, even if it's to invest in solarizing your schools and, you know, getting the school buses to convert to clean energy or electric buses, right, starting with your lowest income districts. I mean, the cost, when we think about the cost, we have to think about it holistically. And how much is it really going to help a family who might get a couple $100 later or even $1,000? I mean, who do they catch up that month? The next month they're still struggling. Yeah. And so instead, if we can reduce the cost and stop paying so much in taxes for cleanup after, you know, these hurricanes and wildfires and all of these kinds of things, stop paying so much into a healthcare system because people are being sick from the pollution, and actually invest in solutions that get us ahead of that and into a new, clean future.
Mm-hmm. Mo, there's a question or two about what people in this room can do to help pass this ballot initiative with all its great provisions.
I thought you would never ask. Thank you. There's a lot. I mean, there's huge business benefit to Initiative 1631, and I think you all probably know what that is. One, it's regulatory certainty. It's having the carbon price on the books, knowing that's the approach, takes away the sword of Damocles with regard to future regulatory approaches. Number two, it invests in incredible, you know, clean energy transition projects that will create jobs and will be a huge boon to the business community in our state. And finally, it invests in things
to address some of those major challenges that our business community faces with regard to the uncertainty of environmental impacts, whether it is the wildfire risk, whether it is flooding that's shutting down I-5, or other impacts. Our challenge in Washington, to be blunt with this audience, is that the business community, with a few exceptions, has mostly engaged to look at policies over the years to just make sure it was okay and it didn't hurt them. And once that was clear, then they stepped back. And what we need from the business community to get good policy over the finish line is engagement in a very proactive way with your brands, with your dollars, and visibly say, this policy is good for us, and hence it tells the public it will be good for you as well. And so I can call out some amazing businesses. We're about to make a big announcement in Washington, so I can't out people yet, but REI is a huge one that has stepped forward and said, 1631 is good for us. For any of you out there who have that opportunity with your business, with your brand, be a voice for vocal engagement. We need you on our endorser list, and we need you engaged.
Customers are looking for that now.
And so we thank you. And we have time for this last question. And Mark, I think I'm going to ask you this, and this is something kind of near and dear to my heart, is how do you message this idea of a carbon tax or carbon pricing, right? So in our community, in our ecosystem of advocates, we use different language. Sometimes we don't want to use the word tax, right? Because it has bad connotations. We heard it was a four-letter word. Price means a bunch of different things to different interest groups. So what is your recommendation, having worked in a number of states?
We keep hoping that we can get people to use price or fee and not use tax. And we keep trying to do that. I'm not sure we'll ever win that battle, but I think the messaging, someone should focus on other words. For example, I've now taken, whenever I can remember to do so, to always say carbon pollution pricing, all right?
Carbon pollution
pricing, that people don't know what carbon pricing is. It right. could be like what you want to raise the cost of pencils. So, you know, people just don't know what that means. They know what pollution is. So that's one part of the messaging, is that we're trying to reduce pollution, and that's okay. both globally and locally.
Good, okay. Well, we're gonna have to call it good there, but I do wanna encourage all of you who are thinking a lot about national policy to also dip in and see what's happening in your own state. You know, these are parallel paths, and I think are important. thank you all, and why don't we have the next panel and final panel of the day come up. Thank you. Thank you, Camila.
Thank you very much.
Good, thanks, Mike. Good, good, thank you.
I do.
Mike, so when you're ready, just go like that. Actually, we'll just leave it there. And
I wasn't in the notes that I was going to have to hit a button. Okay. Oh, look, I can find some of my old questions up here and maybe ask a few. Is the gentleman from Exxon still here?
I don't know. Oh, I see what you want to ask. You want to be green?
Do we have? Okay. Cool. So we're going to go ahead and get things started. We are your fifth in the batting order. I think that's the heart of the lineup. It's also the end of the lineup, fortunate enough for you guys. Thank you for everyone for sticking through today. I know it's been a lot of carbon pricing, UCCL folks are used to these things, but for the rest of you, thank you so much. I also want to thank GAP for hosting us. Let's get a round of applause for GAP.
Yeah.
All right. I was a GAP kid growing up, and also I can definitely say that they're one of the most comfortable khakis as well. They're not paying me to say that, but they're more than welcome to make a donation. Also, just want to introduce myself. My name is Michael Green. I'm the executive director of a group called Climate Exchange. We're the host organization for the Climate Action Business Association. Really happy to be here. You'll see some of our material floating around. First, I encourage you guys to check out our new website that's being launched, climate-exchange.org. And also a great promotion for the organization as well. You're fired up on carbon pricing. You want to do something right now, walking out the door here this evening or maybe later tonight when you're sitting in front of your computer. Check out carbonraffle.org. We're actually going to raise $1 million to support carbon pricing campaigns across the country. And to do it, we're giving away 3 Teslas. Yeah. So go ahead and check that out. That's 3 Teslas. Yeah, the vehicle, carbonraffle.org. So please feel free, folks at home, check it out. You're already in front of your computer. So, you know, tell you a little bit about Climate Exchange and some of the work that we do. We got to see Senator Barrett and Mark Breslow, my colleague, talking on the last panel. Climate Exchange fostered and brought up the State Carbon Pricing Network. We're hosting different campaigns across the country to share best practices, come up with ways that they can work together and find opportunities. And we've also launched a podcast called Cooler Earth, where we're talking about carbon pricing as well as a few other issues, interviewing CEOs, sustainable business leaders, and getting their take on carbon pricing and other issues that matter to them. That's enough about us. We're going to get into these guys a little bit and gals and talk about a few different angles for taking action. I talked about climate exchange and how you can get engaged there, but you know, really want to hear about their theory of change, what they're doing back home when they leave here today, and find out ways that we can take some of their skills, some of their best practices, and really apply it to our efforts, right? Because a lot of folks, you know, here in the room might be working on campaigns. Who here is working on a federal or state carbon pricing campaign in some shape, way, or form? Okay, if your hand's not raised, again, go to one of our organization websites and get plugged in. So great way to find something to do in your free time. Don't worry, we'll take all of it. And find ways for you to get active on carbon pricing. So with that, I want to turn over to Harold over at Business Climate Leaders. And you know, I have my opinions on what's really converted businesses to want to take action on carbon pricing. We've seen a lot of businesses post-election reach out to us, whether it's how do we reassure our employees that we're values aligned, or how do we attract the next wave of millennial workforce and show that we care about climate change. But with Business Climate Leaders, you know, what is the theory of change, and where do you guys see values overlap with the businesses you're working with?
Thanks. Well, you know, we're close to the midterms, and you're hearing a lot in the airwaves right now about you've got to vote. Our theory of change is a little different. It's related. Our theory of change is for business. This is a message for businesses. You've got to lobby, right? That's the way businesses can vote most effectively, is lobbying. So that our method is really aimed at figuring out ways to work with businesses, not only by themselves in DC, but to work in communities. So our paradigm, and this meshes perfectly with the CCL resource, which is chapters in districts around the country covering every congressional office. So we take that as a starting point, and what we want to do is train those local chapters on how to reach out to the business leaders, the small, medium, size enterprises in their places, and train them up to lobby with them. Now, we seed that by working with national companies that we work with. We don't have the bandwidth to work, you know, BCL doesn't have the bandwidth to work in every district, but we do have the bandwidth to talk to national companies that recognize a couple of things. One is that if they've got an employee base that's millennial, those employees want to work at companies that are doing the right thing. And if they work with us and allow those employees to help them lobby locally, so take a hotel chain. I'm not going to tell you which one, but we talked with them, and that's their case. They have got millennial employees that really care about the climate. So that hotel chain, with a simple white paper of here's where we stand on climate change, if they take that and train up those employees to stay on message, they can lobby with us everywhere in the country that they have a hotel. That's a model. And when we have a national chain like that acting locally, it's like an anchor tenant for that chapter to have and go to the other local businesses that are smaller and say, look, we've got whatever the name of the hotel chain is. They're going to lobby with us. We want you to come too, and we're going to talk and influence the member of Congress here to do the right thing on climate. So that's our vision of how to take the local resource that we have and use it effectively by combining both national businesses and small ones. One thing that's been super effective for us, because as you know, Citizens Climate Lobby, we have a proposal, and we train our chapter members up on, this is what we want you to lobby for. We don't do that with businesses because it's too prescriptive, we find. So what we do instead is we ask them, look, what is your climate story? What are the risks that your business sees? What are you doing about it internally? Your supply chain, your efficiency, your reduction of greenhouse gases. Tell that to the member of Congress and then tell them that you support, even if you just say, we support you, we need you to do the right thing on climate, that supports our message. Because those members of Congress have already heard what we have to say about the importance of a carbon tax. They already have heard from us many times. So if the business is in the room with us, what they're really saying is, you figure out the details, I want you to act. So that's another thing that's effective for us.
And one of the things, you know, that I've personally experienced as a large corporate in, but I won't even name the state, reached out to us and said, you know, we don't want to take a stance on carbon pricing because what about our B2B clients? How is this going to affect them? And are we going to potentially lose some of our larger contracts because they're going to say, hey, you know, you are out standing out in front on this climate issue? And you know, think in your head, how many times has a corporate taken an ambitious stance on climate or environmental policy and been burnt on it? Yeah, I really can't think of one. So, you know, we do need first movers and shakers, and whether that's connecting with CCL leaders and going in and working with, you know, I think something Harold said of all sizes and shapes of businesses is really important to meet with congressional folks down in D.C., but maybe not just in D.C., also in state campaigns, right, David? So tell me a little bit, you know, American Sustainable Business Council has really been at the forefront of working on carbon pricing policy. I had the pleasure and was fortunate enough to kind of be in some of those early conversations when we established those, what are our values around carbon pricing? That was about 4 years ago now. How do you see those values being applied to different state and federal campaigns?
I think one of the keys, thank you, you know, one of the keys that we found, you know, was one, it was really crucial to engage the business community. That's why we formed the American Sustainable Business Council, was to say that we'd seen an incredible growth of triple bottom line values emerging within companies, and they were doing the right thing within their company, but they were not telling that story anymore. You have companies that are 100 years old, you know, 120 years old, that have had what you would call core sustainability principles and practice for years, but they never talked about it like that. And what we said was the next core principle was the practice of speaking out and advocating and engaging in the public policy. You know, so whether they did that privately at times and met privately with their representatives, or they actually came out publicly to do that, that was the new opportunity here. And so the emergence of ASBC and a number of other organizations, and then our ability to sort of partner, right, with CABA in Massachusetts, our Connecticut Sustainable Business Council, just as a part of a new formation to bring about a coalition in Connecticut to work on carbon pricing. We talked about the new effort in Pennsylvania. We've worked and tried to support the Washington State folks. In fact, we're going to make some calls when we leave here and get some of our businesses to actually engage on that, right? That those are the opportunities. The place that we start, though, was that you need to have the conversation with businesses in business terms, right? We've seen a lot of whether it's environmental groups or union groups or other groups, say, hey, can you do this? Can you support this? Can you do this? But they put it in the terms that make sense to them, right? Or, right, so starting with business language, with business perspectives is really crucial. Two is to develop a set of principles. We've heard about the politics here, but where do we actually meet each other? We meet each other on the values and the principles that we begin with. So getting responsible, values-based businesses to the table at the very beginning of time to sit down in the crafting of the proposals and coming up with those common principles helped us to navigate some very difficult issues, right? So, you know, on hydraulic fracking, that was it. Key principles helped us to navigate what would allow us to actually move forward on supporting our business in a variety of places. Additionally, the idea of actually working on these issues across size of business is key, right? What is more American in apple pie than small business? We say that, but often they're left out of the equation as well. So building our business coalitions that have small, medium, and large companies is crucial. Minority-owned businesses, women-owned businesses, and telling those stories from that perspective is key. It's not one story that'll help us move the business community forward. You know, so all these play in a really important role on how we've been mobilizing the business community, you know, at the state level, working with state organizations so that they're defining what's important to them at the local level, as well as then using those voices to move the national policy. Yeah?
And the story is really important, and I'm going to circle back to that in a second. But also, you know, those small businesses that are community-based and that are actually doing the work, especially in district, to just touch on it briefly. And it was actually Senator Barrett who this story was with. I was at an event in the State House, and it was very early in organizing on carbon pricing. And I stood in line with all of the other environmental nonprofits and business nonprofits that were in the, you know, acronym soup shaking hands. And right next to me, I had brought a member business, Elephant Walk Restaurant. And I remember that the small business, right, you know, whose mind are they going to change? But I remember when Senator Barrett actually got to the folks at Elephant Walk and shook their hand and realized, oh, you know, these folks are in my district, he immediately stopped. It wasn't just a handshake, but it turned into a conversation. I think they actually talked about how the senator's wife loves their spring rolls, a little pitch for that. But and then it turned into, why are you here? What are you interested in? And he got to tell his story. And being able to have a small business there that can tell why climate change is affecting them and why they care about carbon pricing is so important. Being able to tell, you know, circling around, you know, the ability to tell your stories, whether you're a business leader or not, I think is something that someone here in the audience, my dear friend Katie McDonald and I, took a lot of Marshall Gantz trainings on back when we were student organizers. And being able to effectively tell that to drive action and have people see values alignment is something that we found as student organizers highly effective. So how are we going to be using the student story? And maybe, Kira, is there a way that the student story parlays a little bit with some of these small businesses that are also interested in, you know, that local story of what's happening with climate change near them and why they're interested in acting on carbon pricing?
Yeah, I think definitely. I mean, one of the unique features of a university setting is that you have people from all areas of the country in a lot of these smaller private universities. And so you naturally have people with different life experiences who are coming to this one place with a wealth of different ideas about what should be done on the issue. And business more generally is very inspiring to a lot of young people. We look at business as the winners of our economy and of our country and of American innovation and development. Not even small business specifically, but business in general. And I think that truly is the model for how you will change the narrative on campuses, is you have student leaders who are hoping to one day be successful like businesses and to be the next great CEO of whatever company. And we've grown up in an era where we have only known political divisiveness, and we've only known an era where corporations are seen as people, and so naturally we want to know your values. We want to know how you personally got to where you are and to see you as a person and to really experience what you've experienced and understand the conscientiousness behind it.
Small private universities, you can say at Harvard, you know, is quite a, not only just a small private university, but also a global thought leader. A lot of pressure riding on you and you guys that are organizing. Where do you see this going and growing this semester? And, you know, is there thoughts about how you can engage the private sector through, I don't know, where people are working internships or where people are going and doing their first job placement? Is there, what's the game plan for that?
So for those of you who don't know, I'm with Students for Carbon Dividends, and on our original coalition we launched back in February, there were 23 college Republican clubs who signed on to our initiative supporting the Baker Schultz Carbon Dividend Plan. This is the first time ever that college Republicans have taken any sort of stand on climate, and by definition that means that it's the first time there's been a bipartisan coalition of any sort that's been formed. And each of these students that signed on as a member of these clubs have, in my experience, acted as ambassadors as they're going out. People aren't signing on because it's a whim. People are signing on because it's something they truly believe in. And so necessarily we will be hopefully expanding in the future. We have already added more groups. We are continuing to continue those conversations. And I guess we'll see what's next.
I think the part that I'm the most excited about is something you said about, you know, being the next wave of CEOs. I think that there's a lot of opportunity there for us to be carrying the values of the next generation into the private sector. And, you know, this buzzword that over the last, I don't know, 7 years of disruption, could carbon pricing and kind of wearing your ambition on climate policy like a badge of honor be part of that next wave of disruption, values-aligned businesses?
I absolutely think so. If you look at all the polling, it's a generational schism, truly, on the environment. If you poll people 65 and over, it's less likely that they care about it. People who are in the millennial generation are people who will base their vote on issues such as this. And more broadly, it is those kind of values-aligned issues. Because we're looking at a party structure today on both sides where things are ever-shifting. Your principles honestly couldn't tell you sometimes. But at business, that's what we're looking to set the tone. We're looking to business to say, this is right, this is the American way, this is our way, and we'll follow that.
I want to say something, referring back to what Michael was talking about a minute ago, about the need for principles in getting businesses to start talking. And when you arrive today, or hopefully if you arrived at the beginning at least, there's a piece of paper with some carbon pricing principles that were adopted and developed jointly by American Sustainable Business Council, Business Climate Leaders, and the Series Bicep Program and Partnership for Responsible Growth. So they're shared. And take a look at them because they are a very useful way to start comparing and evaluating carbon taxes and other kinds of carbon pricing proposals. They're values-based, which is what David was pointing to the need for. So I think it's a good resource right there. After and armed with that, you could compare any carbon pricing proposal that comes out and say, well, does it do this? Does it do this? Does it do that? So it's very useful.
So, the other key to what just got mentioned is if we look around at all the campaigns that have taken place on a wide range of issues, what we've often seen is that those that are moving on climate issues and carbon pricing are often sitting in competition with each other as well. Right? So if there's a new set of policies that bring about a new ethos, a new ethic, you know, about what we're trying to accomplish in addressing climate change, you know, through carbon pricing, it's the idea that we need to get all of our organizations actually working together in order to have a more unified voice and a greater power together, because that's the way that we actually move this country forward. So this idea of putting, you know, I'm growing my organization, I'm going after that foundation funding, I'm going after that one company that's going to help to underwrite, you know, my next year's budget or the like, you know, and actually figuring out a game plan that actually gets us to the larger goal of where we're trying to go, which is actually to solve these problems, put, in this case, business at the forefront of innovation to help us move forward, so incentivize business to move forward, but it's going to take a more unified voice, a collective power in order to be able to influence the change at the speed that we need to operate. So if anything, how do we figure out how to make sure that the table is set for all the right folks and the multiple stakeholders that need to be at the table to be working together?
You know, one answer to that, and this ties into something earlier one of you two raised, and that is, what are companies that are afraid of sticking out, but they still want to lead somehow? And one of the ways that we've found it to be effective is to work with trade groups and trade associations. Because in that case, no one company is taking position. I know American Sustainable Business Council does that a lot. We've had good luck working in there. I think Mike Mielke might be in the room here today. If he is, he was earlier. In any case, Mike Mielke is the head of the Silicon Valley Leadership Group. Mm-hmm. And about a year ago, we started talking with Mike about the major companies that are his members. Well, they have small companies too, but the main high-tech companies in the world whose names you all know are members in Mike's company. So these trade groups have to be careful because they're membership-based. They're great allies, but they can't get too far in front of their skis. So in working with them, what we bring to the table is the ability to provide the information, to do the education of companies, to help them discover what a carbon price is going to do to the companies in their sector, what it's going to do to their own companies, and then be able to evaluate carbon pricing principles down the road. And the role of a trade organization like Silicon Valley Leadership Group then is not to provide that leadership on the issue, but to just convene those companies in one place. So that works really well for us because we get to start relating with a bunch of important companies, and it works well for the trade group because they don't have to lead. They can lead from behind just by creating this kind of educational opportunity.
I agree with you. That's a great way to reach out to folks. As someone who, you know, I was the executive director of a business association for the last 5 years and have some experience, it is damn hard trying to get member businesses to show up for things and get engaged. And it's a good way to claim numbers, I think, when you're reaching out to business and trade associations, but you don't get that story, I feel. I think you really need to go to the small business, knock on their door, and have that conversation with them. So maybe a little bit of a difference of opinion on what that looks like, but I want to move our conversation back maybe to the bipartisan theme that we had earlier. The current administration has just been like inept at talking to the voters of a younger generation, I feel like. And this is someone who, you know, I stake claim to upstate New York. We're the most conservative voting county and the most conservative voting town in the most conservative voting county in the state. And take from that where my political affiliation lies from that. But I just can't see them representing my values, especially on this issue. How is that affecting Republican groups on campus? And talk to us a little bit more about how carbon pricing might be an olive branch to bring them back.
Well, I have good news for you. The president does not do legislation. So he truly is not relevant to my pursuits with carbon pricing.
That's all.
Sorry.
No, that's great. And, you know, maybe from your two perspectives, tell us more about how for the, you know, prototypically, if you're working with business owners, they are probably a little bit older than a college student. But with that other generations of people that you're working with that, you know, might, you know, tend to be more conservative if you're a business owner, a lot of times that is the case. But how is the Trump administration affecting your engagement and outreach with business leaders?
Well, I've said, you know, that there's a big uptake in terms of businesses that are actually speaking to their values. Yeah. Some of it's around climate change. Some of it's around pay equity, you know, and some of it's, you know, about the work that they're doing in their communities. Some of it's, you know, we have ASBC has big campaign around high road practices, right? Benefits, minimum wage, you know, paid leave, and other, you know, benefits around family and the like. So companies are stepping out and actually speaking to the opportunity to be able to talk about their values. Why? As we talk, right? It's the consumers, you know, that want to know that they're purchasing from a company that's doing the right thing. It's about the new sets of employees that they want to have, right, that are coming into the workforce that have the values, that are saying, this is my future as well, and I want to work for a company that is doing it right. It's about their present employees that are pushing them to actually take the position. So what's interesting, and you have a few companies here that have found that alignment, is how do you get, you know, the voices of your employees aligned with the, you know, the C-suite, mm-hmm. right? How do you get, though, also the sustainability leaders in companies actually aligned with the policy leaders? If ever we've run into problems before, is that, you know, a lot of sustainability leaders in business will come to us and work with us and then say, oops, sorry, you know, I got to check with the policy department, and the policy department is working in direct opposition,
Constantly happens.
We've had companies that CEOs have actually, of larger companies, CEOs that have said, we're ready to take the position, and then politics have come to play, where their boards of directors were getting calls from some of the other trade associations yeah. and the like, saying, we'll cut off your supply chain if you don't take the right position. So this is not easy to do, but getting internal alignment between employees, C-suite, between policy and sustainability, we see as a key opportunity that it's across, it's no longer siloed work within a company, it's actually integrated into the core of the culture of the company, that this is where they're driving towards. That's key, and that there's a larger vision of who they are as a company that's driving it, so then they can take positions on specific issues as well.
Yeah.
That makes for good business also.
That's the argument we're making.
Right, exactly.
So if you haven't started to write your questions to us, please feel free. I've got a few in front of me, and I'm going to skip my last question because I really like a few of these. One of which is actually it's a question on divestment. I'm not going to ask it because it made me have another question. But on campus, there seems to be a little bit of a... You know, there's only so many students, and we were talking about the competitiveness in the nonprofit space, and yeah, it's competitive in the private sector as well, but guess what, guys? It's competitive to get students to show up on Thursday nights for pizza parties to talk about environmental issues, and one of the things that we've seen a divide on in the past is around divestment and carbon pricing. Is that still something that you see? Is there any kind of coming together of those two thoughts? That the question was asking you to take a stance on divestment. We're not going to do that because this is a carbon pricing forum. But talk to me a little bit about the clashing. Are we coming together on campus?
Honestly, no clashing in my experience.
Great.
We've been very lucky. Like, we've been working somewhat towards a common cause. Where we're aligned, we agree. Where we're not aligned, no harm done.
Okay. No, that's great to see that hatchet might have been buried. You know, we had early days in carbon pricing in Massachusetts where there was divestment students standing out and doing protests, actually, of the conversation of carbon pricing. So it's great to see that students graduate, new students come in, and that disappears. So
now they're elected.
Yeah, now they're running for office.
They're running for office. So that's the conflict.
You see? Yeah.
Now that we're beyond that problem, the new fists of young folks are to get elected. We won't have that problem anymore. There you go.
Yeah.
Well, job done.
So I think there's also a little bit of stalking the pond, if you will, on my questions. You two are sitting next to each other because you asked the same question. So I'll go ahead with it. Colin Kaepernick, Nike, are they out in front? Are they leading and stepping out on an issue? Yeah, they asked the same question. I mean,
that's the question is not are they stepping out. Clearly, they're stepping out, and
nobody's wearing Nikes. Okay.
Huh?
None of us are wearing Nikes.
It's all good, but the key is that, you know, look, Nike's a company that understands very well, right? That was one of the most recognized campaigns against Nike, right? and their factories overseas and the like, and it sort of, you know, did that have an impact on the way that they looked at their own internal practices and how that played out? Clearly, you know, that's a part of what has moved some companies, right, to sort of shift their practices and sometimes put new leadership in place, and sometimes it's just different internal policies, and sometimes it's the external campaigns that they're trying to message out to a larger public about what they're doing. You know, that's a piece of what that pressure of corporate campaigns has mattered to businesses, particularly the public-facing ones, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
So that's another, if we look at levers and impacts, that has certainly worked, you know, in a bunch of cases. The idea here now is that we're trying to say, let's create the ground for businesses to be able to step forward, do the right thing, before you hit those moments of corporate campaigns that are going to pressure companies into doing the right thing. We want to create the conditions that make it a positive opportunity, you know, that we're incentivizing companies to actually do the right thing at this point in history.
Do the right thing. Someone might say, just do it, right? So another question here coming from the audience, and thank you everyone for submitting your questions. One of the questions actually on someone who's frustrated working with their local chamber of commerce. They're telling me here on the card, I feel like I'm reading like I'm a letters to the editor here a little bit, but they're telling me they're frustrated with their local chamber of commerce. It's heavily influenced by the fossil fuel industry. How do they get around that? How do they influence them?
So there's been several ways that it's been approached. There's been the formation of a lot of other business organizations at the local level, right? Mitch, that was up here before, was working, you know, with Voices of Oregon Innovation and Sustainability, right? You know, our friends at Earth Friendly Products are a part of our New Jersey Sustainable Business Council, right? And all these other, so there have been formation of other councils as well. But we've also seen, you know, you know, some of the local chambers have actually, the San Francisco Chamber has been extremely supportive of a lot of important issues on environment and climate and the like. So you see that moving. But I think the key is, you know, what's a strategy, what's a theory of change of working within organizations that have historically taken perhaps the wrong positions on this, mm-hmm. which is to actually get enough of the numbers up that it actually transforms the culture
right.
and the positions of there, get enough people in leadership positions within those, you know, it's more of the problems have existed at the state chamber level, mm-hmm. you know, because it's then more heavily dominated by the positions of the U.S. chamber in certain cases. So this idea of being able to rise up in numbers, find your allies within whatever organization you're working in order to be able to shift the priorities is a key opportunity, and that's why good dialogue, good education, good training of business leaders to prepare them to be more able to influence others, you know, is getting good business case materials out there that we're all trying to produce as well as we can, yeah, you know, is all a part of the process, I think, of actually transforming all of these organizations. But where they're not working, is start to form the other organizations
the alternative.
That will actually be directly aligned and
creating
watch
those alternatives.
Watch the membership start to shift, and then they'll either change or die, right?
And that's something, and he says that, and you know, you heard it here first, maybe, but the days of the Chamber of Commerce are kind of limited in on their way out. The Chambers of Commerce and Rotary Clubs, I'm throwing you in there with them. Because I think the community of a business actually looks more like WeWorks and work bars and startup hubs and accelerator programs, and it's filled with young people that are part of those real, honest communities.
Just quickly about the Rotary Club just invited me to speak on a large conference in Mexico on human values, where they're going to get 4,000 people, and they're a part of trying to, the Rotary about aligning human values and values that they stand, right?
Rotary gets it. Okay, I take so it I back.
Just, all right, I just.
But we've got this amazing community in Boston. It's a space filled with, what's up, Boston? It's a space filled with the next wave of technologies and just brilliant business models. It's called Greentown Labs. And one of the things that makes me so encouraged every single time that I go there is the young people and the kind of next wave of CEOs, entrepreneurs that are filling that. How do we engage those next CEOs? How do we get them, all right, you've got the technology and your values are there whether you know it or not. How do we talk to them about carbon pricing?
Well, I actually disagree with you on the days of the Chambers of Commerce and local government more broadly. I think part of all of this is making young people feel connected to their communities. I'm lucky to have been born and raised in Ketchikan, Alaska. It's a small island community in southern southeast Alaska. And the people that I know there are my family, and they have my values. And that matters to me, and that's what we're seeking in these smaller businesses especially, is that kind of community that we may be lacking. Like when we move to these bigger urban areas, I just moved to Boston a couple years ago, and those kind of communities matter,
of course.
That's what we're seeking out.
And I don't think I'm not saying that the function of a chamber of commerce is different, but the theory of a chamber of commerce and what that looks like is evolving. So for us in Boston, it looks more like local first chapters or Main Street collaboratives, versus the Boston Chamber, to me, is a bit disconnected from actually a lot of the businesses in Boston that are maybe a little bit more values aligned.
I would be not so hasty at dismissing Rotaries and Chambers of Commerce. In rural America, they are still a very positive force in many cases, particularly, excuse me for a second, in Idaho. I'll give you an example. We're able to very effectively, one of our key members who works in marketing for the local public radio station, started joining and attending Rotary meetings and made many, many speeches in that region, not just the one club. And when we went up there to start putting together a meeting with Congressman Mike Simpson, a Republican, she was very able to start bringing in local businesses who are willing to tell their climate story to the member of Congress. Now, that doesn't mean they came in and said, I support carbon fee and dividend, but they were willing to be there and say, here's how climate change is affecting my business, here's what we're doing. And in that meeting, when we finally had it, we not only had the small businesses, but we were able to, again, seed that with, we had a Cliff Bar there, we have a bakery in the area, and we had a local employee from Hewlett Packard. So that diversity there, a big part of it came from working with the local community, the Rotary Clubs. Now, the other strategy that CCL has, we have an action team really devoted to training people how to work in those rural places, in those Rotary Club environments. If you join and you become part of that group, they're good people, and they listen, and they're doing service, and you find out that you can make a difference by working with them.
They meet every Monday night in Boston if you're looking to join them. I have joined them. We're going to move into some hot button issues and just kind of work through it with our last 2 minutes and 30 seconds. One of the questions was, what's the most important part of a design? If you were to give us three aspects that are the most important part of a carbon pricing policy design, what are those three?
Well, we talked about it a little earlier, but the simplest are the three E's: effective, equitable, and efficient.
I would just say that it has to be plausible for implementation. It needs to be bipartisan, and it needs to have actual political viability.
So comprehensive, that it's working, that there's not all these carve-outs, right, across the board that we start to have, that it's a true price, that it's the real price, right? It's important as well. That we're applying it, we talked about upstream is the way it was talked, at the source, that we're really getting to the heart of the matter in terms of where it's being created and making sure that it's being priced there. And in the case here, as well, is that we're building a new, strong, vibrant, just, sustainable economy at the local, at the state, at the regional, and at the national level. That we're building a new American economy based on a different set of values in which carbon pricing plays a role, so that we hold the big vision also of the economy that we're working towards. And this is a tool to actually help us to get there, is some of the key elements.
All right. So, and for the last question, just briefly, there's a lot of people streaming, lots of folks here still in the building. How can they find out more about what you're up to? And is there maybe one tool that you want to highlight that you're able to offer?
You can find us at s4cd.org, and that's the number 4.
I would definitely recommend two websites. There's the citizensclimatelobby.org. You find about an incredibly rich infrastructure of support for volunteers there. And of course, Business Climate Leaders, we have a businessclimateleaders.org website as well. You'll find out more about what we specifically are doing as an action team.
Well, you know, again, we're the American Sustainable Business Council, but we have all these state and local business councils that either we've helped to build or that were pre-built before that we're happy to put folks in touch with. And then just one final plea again for us, let's continue to figure out how to build this work together with each other. You know, we brought up a Republican business leader, you know, to Capitol Hill to testify, you know, and he started his testimony by saying, I'm an unrepentant Republican. And the Republican chair stopped the hearing completely and said, there's no way that the Democrats would go to the American Sustainable Business Council, who would then go to a Republican to bring them up to testify. And what he said is, I am here because it's not what's good for Republicans or for Democrats. It's what's good for business and what's good for my grandchildren. Mm-hmm. Now's the time for business leaders and future business leaders to be stepping up and for us to be doing this together so we can actually create the change that allows us to have many generations to come, yes?
Absolutely. And I would like to thank our wonderful panel. My name is Mike Green with Climate Exchange. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, folks. And now I think I'm going to hand it over to Richard.
Well, that's a wrap. Richard and I just wanted to make a couple of quick closing comments, and then we'll all head out to the wonderful reception that's just right out in the lobby. First of all, a really big special thanks to our friends at The Gap, in particular, Christina Nicholson, Belinda Serha, and Laura Wilkinson. If we could give them another round of applause, I'd really appreciate that. It's just been a real pleasure working with you to put on this event in your wonderful facility. And to our great sponsors, thank you so much for your support, and to our speakers for such a stimulating exchange of ideas throughout the day. So per the title of our event, the U.S. Business Case for a Carbon Tax, what we really wanted to demonstrate today was that a well-designed carbon pricing legislation, well-designed carbon tax, will actually be good for U.S. businesses. And importantly, we need more U.S. businesses to step up and advocate for carbon pricing. At the same time, we wanted to demonstrate that increasingly across the political spectrum, leaders from government, from NGOs, and from business are embracing carbon pricing as policy that they feel will be effective going forward. At Business Climate Leaders, our team at Business Climate Leaders, and all of our 100,000 members within CCL, we firmly believe that the next best step to address the risks of climate change is an effective, steadily rising price on carbon. And not only addressing the risks of climate change, I think it's also important to point out that this is the way that we're going to unleash the economic benefits of moving to a clean energy economy. So I know most of you in this room are also working towards a similar objective, or many of you are. And if today has inspired you to join us in our advocacy efforts, we'd really love to talk with you afterwards during the reception or at any time when you could get that you would like to get in touch with us. So thank you once again for your participation. We really appreciate it. Richard, you have the last word.
Thank you all for being here, spending the day with us, learning, adding to the conversation. And you know, this is still at an early stage, this idea of a carbon tax, but it is a revolutionary idea that's gaining currency, as Steve has said. So we need to keep pushing it. And we're not sure what the tipping point may be. It may only be a year, it may be 5 years. But as we see across the world, this is gaining currency, and that's really encouraging. So for me, a few takeaways. One, it's really important to work in coalition. So we have student allies at, I think there are 35 campuses across the country, Future 500. Bill Shireman's organization is working with other student groups across the country on something called the Bridge Alliance, right? Which is looking at the importance of climate change to that demographic's future. Labor unions are interested in this issue. 2 days ago, Richard Trumka, the president of the AFL-CIO, said, we're all in, and at the same time, we don't want this transition to be accomplished on the backs of American workers. And what the subtext was, if you close all our coal plants down, you better make sure that there's some appropriate transitional funding to support the workers. So the coalitions are important. Another big takeaway is, let's not let the perfect be the enemy of the good, right? And we've heard lots of interesting proposals. There are variances here. We don't know what the final outcome will be, but we do need to be, flexible, I think, in our approach. And finally, as I'm always fond of saying, it's better to be at the table than on the menu, because that way you get to decide or have an influence on what the decision is. So finally, I wanted to give a shout out to one of our colleagues who's been in the background all day, Randy Salim, who has been just... has been really wonderful to work with. And we also have two colleagues who are not here with us today, Sarah McGregor, who's in Massachusetts. And Sarah, if you're watching, thank you very much. And also Stephanie Miller, who helped a lot with our communications. So our next step, we've been thinking that it would be great to replicate this, this carbon tax forum, and maybe do it in Washington, D.C. in the spring. So if any of you were interested in that, come talk to Steve or I. We'd be happy to discuss that possibility with you. And we do have a reception out in the hall, and we hope you hang out for an hour and have some adult beverages with us. So thank you all very much. Thank you, Steve. It's good. Very good.
We can't make any promises now, can we, babe?